Breaking Financial Hardship by David O. Oyedepo. Introduction. Prophetically, financial hardship is unavoidable. It is in God's divine program that this world will be humble to respect God. This generation of proud men and women will be brought to their knees to know that there is a true God. Every time God wants to humble a people, one of the things he uses is hunger. And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger. Deuteronomy 8 verse 3. He humbled them with hunger, thirst, and nakedness. It is easier to get at a man using food as a weapon. God is going to humble this generation. There is going to be a wave of financial hardship, which has been gathering momentum for the past few years. Many are already victims. God has said, this earth will burn like an oven. The reason is just to humble the proud. God is targeting the proud so that he can humble them. The time has come to humiliate them. While the time of manifestation has come for the saint, can you not see that the earth has started burning already? The time has come for all that do wickedly to know that God is the governor amongst nations. Everyone you see today that is not a Christian has a bleak future, no matter what he has gathered. But while the world is going through humiliation, there will be exaltation for the saints. In 1 John 1 verse 1, John boldly declared, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. It is time to come out as a son of God, a covenant saint, and humiliate the devil. Today, by the grace of God, I am able to give neat money in the millions range, unsolicited for, money not begged for, simply given from above. You don't have to suffer with Nigerians if you are a Nigerian, nor with Americans if you are an American. If you see yourself as a Nigerian, an American, or a South African, you will suffer what they suffer and die the way they die. Covenant riches, when you hit it, covers all areas of your life. For the blessings of the Lord, it maketh rich, and he added no sorrow with it. Proverbs 10 verse 22. When your riches come from God, they are sorrow free. They eliminate sickness and family stress. The devil cannot kill you when God is blessing you. I have seen myself still jumping about at a very old age. When you are blessed of God, you are sustained by him. It is not enough to acquire money. It must be with the rest. I had been at rest long before I had physical money. God is not benefiting from your poverty, and it is not giving him glory. You don't resemble God by being poor. He built mansions up there. It sure takes somebody that has money to do that. The streets of heaven are paved with gold. That takes money too. If you are in his image, you have access to his riches. It is understanding that you need. Good understanding giveth favor, but the way of the transgressors is hard. Proverbs 13 verse 15. The psalmist said, give me understanding and I shall live. The opposite of good understanding is ignorance. Good understanding provides ease and comfort, while ignorance opens you up to hardship. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. He said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. This means that when quality knowledge comes, quality freedom is experienced. Hardship is real, but the comfort of the Holy Spirit for the saints is equally real. Everyone that reads this book is a candidate for covenant wealth. You will contact it in Jesus' name. Chapter 1, God's prophetic agenda. Prophecies are heaven's agenda for mankind on the earth. Let us now examine some of God's prophetic utterances which relate to the times from his word. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. Isaiah 60 verse 2. God's word says, the darkness shall cover the earth. The use of the article the signifies that Darkness has been programmed to cover the earth. It is a programmed event. It has been determined against the earth. This darkness will not be partial. It will be total. There will be total and complete absence of light for the people of the world. The things that will happen will defy every known solution. Men will run from pillar to post, but all in vain. All answers will elude them. The only light that shall be seen will be a mysterious light shining from above. This is the light of God's glory, which he will release upon his people alone. The word of God in Malachi 4 verse 1 says, "For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble, and the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch." There is no shortcut. The ones you run to for help also need help. If the Bible says the earth shall burn like an oven, and all those who do wickedly shall be burnt and become stubble without root nor branch, then who shall help? When the Lord says that the earth shall burn like an oven, do not imagine that there will be flames of fire leaping all over the place. What is an oven? It is an enclosed box-like space heated for baking. When you open an oven, you don't see the flames, you only feel the heat. This is God's prophetic agenda. All the scientific and economic experts' theories will be destroyed. The earth will burn like an oven. The foundation of the mighty shall be shaken. The heat will burn them up, and they will come tumbling down to nothingness. This is God's agenda for the world. It is happening already. If your five physical senses are still alive, you will know that these prophecies are not idle words. You do not need any spiritual sense to know that things have already started to fall apart. The word of God concerning this event do not sound like prophecies anymore, because they are happening already and we are all witnesses. Education, for example, used to be seen as the answer to man's social problem. But now, all over the world, education is failing. Young men and women are turned out of the universities annually without any hope of employment. Every trade and profession has its long list of disappointments. No career is exempted. Money is already failing in so many countries. Money is fast losing its value. The lower denomination of currencies in some countries are already being phased out. As it was in Egypt of old, so shall it be in these times. And when money failed in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan, all the Egyptians came unto Joseph and said, "Give us bread, for why should we die in thy presence, for the money faileth." Genesis 47 verse 15. Money failure or devaluation is not strange. There is nothing new under the sun. Joseph said, "Give your cattle, and I will give you for your cattle if money fail." Genesis 4 verse 16. Are people not selling their property for food now? Not everybody who is selling a car now has to. People are selling their cars to buy food. We can see these things happening around us. Some individuals have just one house and have had to sell it to become tenants. All the proud and all sinners will pay dearly for kicking against God. All Egyptians, senators, governors, etc. had to sell their lands, and the lands became Pharaoh's. Supernatural providence is real. How do we triumph in a world of failure? How do we excel in a world of depression? How do we get exempted from the general menacing turn of events. But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings, and ye shall go forth and grow up like calves in the stall. Malachi 4 verse 2. There is a need to understand the fact that you do not have the capacity of your own to handle the oncoming Holocaust. The times ahead are impossible times with human strength. God has mapped out his agenda for mankind on the earth. You can cast out demons, but you cannot cast out prophecies. At the time of the birth of Jesus, Herod tried hard to kill him. He was afraid of the prophecies concerning Jesus and tried to prevent them from coming to pass by killing Jesus. He only succeeded in killing everyone else. He could not destroy God's agenda. Now you have heard about God's agenda for these times. All you need to do is to key in on the right side, which is God's side, so you don't get burnt with the system. It is true that the system will collapse. It is also true that many companies will fold up and men will sell off almost everything they have to survive. But all these things will not move the children of God. God will promote his people to a point where sinners will find it impossible to do without them. He will stir up so much jealousy through this promotion that the world will be forced to recognize the church as a force to be reckoned with on the earth. The people of God will have divine sufficiency in the midst of worldwide lack. This is a thing of joy to note. Now try this. Switch on your living room light at midday. What effect do you notice? Does it enhance your visibility? No. Can it be noticed by passers-by? No. But when it is 9 p.m., everywhere is dark. Then switch on the light in your living room. Is there any remarkable effect? The answer is a loud yes. Everywhere is illuminated, thereby enhancing your visibility. If there is no light in every other part of the house, everyone troops to the living room where there is light. Passers-by see the light and recognize immediately that there is a light on and that possibly someone is home. If there is no light in the house at that time, it is assumed that there is no one in the house and intending visitors go back. You can only show the profitability of light where there is darkness. The beauty and desirability of light is enhanced in a place of total darkness. This is the plan of God. The light of God is going to shine upon God's people in a time of total darkness upon the earth, a time when dealing in hard drugs will fail, when techniques and expertise will be of no help, and the so-called overlords will become underdogs. This is the time that those who fear God will be lifted, and all eyes shall see and know that their lifting is of God. Then shall it be clear to the world that there is profit in serving God. The beauty and desirability of Christianity will be revealed, and the Gentiles shall troop to the brightness of the rising of those who fear God. Consider Jesus. There was once a group of people living under severe hardship. The Jews in Palestine under the old Roman Empire were a battered and defeated set of people. There was hunger everywhere. Political and religious victimization was the order of the day. Then a man appeared on the scene. His name is Jesus. He was a man anointed by God, and he had solutions to every problem. He stood as a shining light, a city set on the hill that could not be hid. In him the lame received strength to walk, the blind got back their sight, and the dumb spoke clearly. Every problem bowed to his authority. The storm heard him and lost its speech. The sea became solid ground under his feet. In his presence, the philosophers lost their reasoning, the religious experts lost their tongues, and the mouths of the political overlords were thrown open in amazement. This is Jesus manifesting divine presence among men. People from all walks of life flocked around him. Thousands and thousands trooped to this light, which was lightening up the heart and soul of mankind. A day came and they all found themselves in the wilderness, a place of dire need. Some of them had money, but there was nothing to buy. However, the majority of them had nothing, and there was no hope of being fed in that wilderness. They were hungry, exhausted, and at their wit's end. But Jesus was there, and in a place of apparent lack and want, 5,000 men, excluding women and children, were supernaturally fed. Through Jesus, the Most High God demonstrated his supernatural providence in the midst of lack. The people wanted to take him and make him king by force, but he escaped from them. This is what God wants to do with you this end time. Consider this and get yourself positioned for your lifting. The moon has no light of its own. It only reflects the light from the sun. Its position to the sun determines the light it reflects. God is out to distinguish his church, but you have to distinguish yourself in your walk with him to reflect his glory. Right choices. Another reason God will satisfy his people with good things during the hard times ahead is to ensure that they can make the right choices whenever they are tempted. The word of God says, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good." Isaiah 7 verse 14 to 15. Supernatural providence is one of God's instruments to keep his people clean. He says he will make sure his people have provisions of what makes for life in its fullness, so they will be able to make the right choices when tempted. Jesus never begged or stole to get his needs met. The Bible tells us that his boat had a special sleeping cabinet where he laid on a pillow. When it was time for the Passover, he did not use an ordinary room. He reserved the upper room for himself and his disciples. He needed a treasurer to carry his money. The treasurer, Judas, was given a free rein to spend the money for whatever was needed without rendering accounts to anyone. He even ended up stealing from the money bag, but this did not affect Jesus in any way. Jesus had a coat that was not common, but apparently very beautiful, and the rough soldiers could not bear to tear it to pieces. They cast lots for it. This was the kind of butter and honey Jesus had. But hear what the word of God says. "For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich." 2 Corinthians 8 verse 9. All that we read of Jesus in the four Gospels represent poverty compared to the riches which he left in heaven. These are the riches God has reserved for you in heaven. God says all that was portrayed by Jesus while on earth is poverty when compared to the riches which he has reserved for you. Can you begin to imagine what God is talking about? What goes on in the world does not matter. In fact, The harder the times are in the world, the more supplies he will release to those that walk in his ways so that they can make their choice. They will not need to steal to live well. You will be exempted. In the midst of the burning heat in Egypt, there were a group of people that the heat did not affect, and Israel dwelt in the land of Egypt, in the country of Goshen, and they had possession therein, and grew and multiplied exceedingly. Genesis 47 verse 27. The children of Israel arrived Egypt in chapter 46, and in chapter 47 they already had possessions. When hunger began to knock at the doors of the Egyptians, covenant people began to acquire wealth. The riches of the sinners are laid up for the righteous. Tell anybody, let them be angry. The truth is that no man has a future except he has Jesus. No matter the connections you have, you cannot break scriptures. All the proud and sinners will pay dearly for kicking against God. This is the best time to be proud of Jesus. We are the only people that matter in this era. Romans 8 verse 19 says, "For the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God." You will be part of the answer to the question of the sinners. Israel dwelt in the land of Egypt and did not feel the heat. You will not feel the heat of the economic dirt in the country where you live. Friend, where you are living does not matter. Israel was in Egypt and prospered in the face of famine. You will prosper in Jesus' name. They grew and multiplied exceedingly. This is the time your God will show you that He is your God. What made Israel different? They are God's chosen people. If you were not chosen, you would not have been saved. Chosen as what? Chosen so you can become covenant people. Israel is God's covenant people on the earth. So when you are born again, you become God's chosen vessel. By this, you become a covenant child, and the covenant is superior to any climate. No matter what obtains on the earth, the covenant will distinguish God's people. Jacob came down to Egypt and stayed there for 17 years. And in those 17 years, the children of Israel took over the economy of the entire land. Every Egyptian lost his assets, and Israel had all assets at their disposal. They multiplied while the owners of the land went down. Friend, the covenant makes the difference. Chapter 2, The Covenant. The covenant is God's hammer for breaking financial hardship. An understanding of the covenant will make you prevail on the earth against all odds. This is your sacred card for breaking financial hardship. You must be an Israelite, i.e. born again. You must have a working knowledge of the covenant. With all humility, I am glad to tell you that I contacted a working knowledge of the covenant, and I know when I did. It has not failed once since then. The covenant will distinguish you, no matter the degree of hardship that is prevailing on the earth. A very clear understanding of the covenant will make you great on the earth. This is the difference between the winning Christian and the losing one. You are chosen, yes, but are you walking in the covenant? If you don't have a walking knowledge of the covenant, you will not be different from the world. Hardship is not for you. It is not your destiny. I have read the will of God. He wills above all things that I may prosper and be in health, even as my soul prospers. 3 John 2. God's will for me is to prosper. He takes pleasure in my prosperity. He doesn't take pleasure in my hardship. Pray that God grants you access to the working knowledge of the covenant. The covenant is it. Ask the Lord to deliver to you the covenant hammer that will break the financial hardship of this era in your life. Many years ago, I was studying the word and waiting on the Lord, and suddenly a hammer was delivered into my hands. I took hold of it and declared, I can never before. That was not an empty or fake confession. I knew what I was saying and what had been delivered to me. It has never disappointed me once. Friends, it is time to begin to hunger and thirst for this same hammer to be delivered to you. Many Christians are still doing trial and error. When it is delivered to you, you will know the mystery of the covenant. For the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and depth, that springs out of valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley and vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of oil, olive and honey, a land wherein thou shalt eat bread without curseness, thou shalt not lack anything in it, a land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he has given thee. Deuteronomy 8 verse 7 to 10. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he swore unto thy fathers, as it is this day. Deuteronomy 8 18. What is that covenant? There is what is called power to get wealth, power for wealth, or divine ability for abundance, otherwise known as divine providence, which operates on the platform of the covenant. It is not a promise you claim in prayer. It is not a desire you enforce by fasting. It is an agreement you enter into with God, which gets him committed to your needs. Wealth in the kingdom does not answer to prayers, nor does it have respect for fasting. It only answers to a qualitative covenant work. There is a land in the spirit world where there shall not be lack of anything, where you shall eat bread without scarceness. It's a land of brooks and fountains that springs out of valleys and mountains, full of treasures whose stones are iron, and out of whose rocks you may dig brass. There is a land of plenty in the kingdom of God, a spiritual land which you enter into by covenant, by understanding the agreement that makes it work. It does not answer to prayer. Length of fasting does not move it to work for you, nor does concern of the brethren affect it. The subject of wealth in the kingdom only thrives on the covenant. Friends, it is time to get drunk with this truth. Jesus came here eating butter and honey. Isaiah 7 verse 14 to 15. You are not sent to eat sand and gravel. Jesus could say, woe unto you, Pharisees. He did not need their money. He was not looking up to them for anything. He was connected to a never-ending source. Poverty does not make you resemble Jesus. May God deliver you from it. He said prophetically in Psalm 45 verse 4, and in thy majesty ride prosperously because of truth and meekness and righteousness, and thy right hand shall teach thee terrible things. Jesus was riding prosperously and in majesty when he was on earth. Divine providence works anytime, anywhere. Citizens of the covenant world are prosperous people. I have seen people who are celebrities in the teaching of prosperity, yet victim of poverty. They are professors, not professionals. They have no working knowledge of the covenant, so they are not working in it, and consequently have no results to show. Good understanding giveth favor. Proverbs 13 verse 15. If you will open your heart to the mystery of the covenant, you will go up. Nothing on earth will be able to tie you down again. In Genesis 12, when God told Abraham to get out of his country and from his kindred and his father's house unto a land that he will show him, he promised him that, and I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed.
Yes, Genesis 12, verse 2 to 3. Then we are told in chapter 13 that, "And Abraham was very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold." Genesis 13, verse 2. Riches is the will of God for you. It is a covenant with a full package of blessings that continues in a cycle. You will be blessed and you will be a blessing. So the blessing is continuous as we increasingly multiply in blessing others. You can only prosper by reason of your covenant walk with God. Stop chasing after men and money. Lay hold on the covenant. Men will be dethroned. Businesses will crash. Money will fail. But the covenant cannot crash. It can never fail. God has said, "If my covenant be not with day and night, and if I have not appointed the ordinances of heaven and earth, then will I cast away the seed of Jacob and David my servant, so that I will not take any of his seed to be rulers over the seed of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For I will cause their captivity to return and have mercy on them." Jeremiah 33 verse 25 to 26. As long as the day and night continue to exist, then recognize that the covenant of God with his people is effectively in force. Wealth is with God, but he has given men the power to get it. Therefore, the key that unlocks God's treasures has been given to men. All those who operate it have testimonies to show for it. Covenant wealth is not an issue of luck or chance. It has no bearing with the country you are living in. The economic policy of the nation has no relevance to it. It has to do with your willingness and obedience to the terms of that covenant. The time has come for you to walk into financial liberty. No matter how dry the land becomes, your covenant land will keep on producing. It will remain like brooks and fountains, giving you honey and oil all the days of your life. Seed time and harvest. There is a law that guarantees peace and the release of goodness and mercy. There is a law that connects you to the source and moves God in your favor to release the goodies of heaven for you. It's a law that makes living comfortable for you and makes money lose value to you by reason of its abundance. This law does not only bless you but protects the blessing as well. It is the law of seed time and harvest. Genesis 8 verse 22 is where the covenant of exemption from hardship took off. That is where it all began. And Noah built an altar unto the Lord and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savour. And the Lord said in his heart, "I will not again curse the ground anymore. While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest shall not cease." Genesis 8 verse 20 to 22. God is saying here that only those who sow seeds shall have a harvest. In chapter 3 of Genesis, he cursed the whole earth after man fell. He said to Adam, "Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread till thou return unto the ground." Genesis 3 verse 17 to 19. But after Noah's offering and sacrifice in Genesis 8 verse 20, of which God smelled a sweet savour, God said he will no longer curse the earth anymore. Instead, he decreed that seed time and harvest time, summer and winter, cold and heat shall not cease. That is the law. Harvest responds only to seed, not to prayers, fasting, human connection or positions. Only to seed. Only seed sown equals harvest. Until seed is sown, harvest is not in view. That is the law of abundance. God is not in need and can never be. So, whatever he is saying is not to his benefit, but for yours. His commandments are not to grieve you, but to groom you. They are not to hurt you. They are to help you. They are not to pull you down, but to build you up. As long as day and night are exchanging positions, cold and heat are exchanging their seasons, summer and winter are exchanging their times, seed time and harvest is in force. It is a covenant and not a promise. A covenant has a stronger force with God than a promise. He said, my covenant will I not break, nor alter the things that is gone out of my lips. Psalm 89 verse 34. The law became a covenant in Abraham. For there is what man must do for God to act. God is not permitted to bring increases until man has committed himself to sowing seeds. If there must be harvest, there must be seed sown. That is the law, and the scriptures cannot be broken. Neither prayers nor fastings can break it. Tears or prayers of agreement can't either. Covenant exercise. Before you become a heavyweight champion or success, you need to engage in heavyweight exercises and practices. There is something to do in the secret in order to shine in the open. You must believe in the place of exercises for championship. You will never taste championship status until you believe in the law of rigorous exercise. You don't become a star in sports just because you have the natural potential, but rather through the principles of rigorous exercises. Similarly, you don't become a star in the kingdom until you begin to exercise yourself in the covenant. There are demands in the book, the Bible, that requires rigorous exercises before you can attain the promises. For example, we are all potentially seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. So potentially, we are all first-class citizens. But we need first-class exercises to attain to that position in the physical. In 1 Timothy 4 verse 8, the Bible says, for bodily exercise profiteth little. Records and proofs abound of sports stars all over the world. They live in the best houses and ride the best cars. They belong to a special class. However, none of these athletes achieved stardom without a commitment to physical exercises. But the Bible says that is little compared to the profit that accrues from godly exercise. Exercise thyself rather unto godliness. Godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. 1 Timothy 4 verse 7 to 8. This is the missing knowledge in the church. We wait for God to do it. Can you imagine a sportsman waiting for the day God will make him a champion? He will never become one. If you sit down waiting for the day God will make you a sports star, you will wait forever and your generation after you will never see a sports star. God says you should exercise yourself unto godliness, for bodily exercise profits little compared to the profit that comes your way through godly exercises. You don't have to wait for opportunities. You go in search of them. Let's look at the following illustrations in Deuteronomy 32 verse 9 to 10. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the Lord of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land and in the waste howling wilderness. He led him about. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye. That means in the midst of those exercises, he saw to it that he did not perish or get destroyed. By such training and exercises, he made him ride on the high places. Verses 11 to 12. To ride on your high place, you need to take instructions for your upbringing. You need to be subject to the referee of your life, which is God's word. If the eaglet is never trained to fly, it will die up there in the nest. So have many Christians died in their nest while they are yet alive. They have never exercised themselves unto the high flying status of life. You will never become a financial star until you engage in financial covenant exercises. You will never smell plenty. You will keep struggling with scarcity. It takes the eagle's game to become a 10,000 feet high flying eagle. Eaglets are born, but eagles are made. We are not all children of God. There are sons out there, and so are there men of God. But there are also friends of God in the order of Abraham. There are disciples and there are apostles. It is not title, it is status. Titles are mere identities, but status Jesus is an accomplishment. It is worked for. You can call yourself by any name, but only your status reveals your actual worth, accomplishment, and capability. It's time to fly out of your nest and take part in the game of ego. Greatness is prepared for. Concerning Jotham, the Bible says in 2 Chronicles 27 verse 6, Jotham became mighty because he prepared his ways before the Lord his God. Greatness is prepared for. It is not jumped into or stumbled upon. Nobody succeeds by accident. Every great sportsman made some great preparation to attain his greatness. He created avenues for exercises. He didn't wait for it. You need spiritual exercises to attain your inheritance in life. Can you imagine a sportsman aiming at a championship and all he does is fast and pray? He will never get there. The demands of championship does not reckon with fasting and prayers, but with rigorous exercises. Exercises first, then fasting and prayers later. For the attacks that may come against you on your way to making the championship, you need to put your muscles under the correct tension through exercises so you can go through the contest. You don't become a star by wishing, nor do you become one by waiting. You become a star by working. Therefore, lift up the hands that hang down. The greater your preparation in any area, the greater your results. He that prepares sparingly shall reap sparing results, and he that prepares bountifully shall reap bountiful results. There is need to prepare your way before the Lord. You must exercise yourself to your rights and inheritance before you realize them. In Proverbs 13 verse 11, the Bible says, wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished, but he that gathereth by labor shall increase. We need to understand the type of labor the Bible is talking about here. Think of the prodigal son. He never worked for anything. He just collected everything his father had for him, and it didn't take him time to squander it all. That was because he never worked for it, so he didn't have the capacity to retain it. This is the case with many children of the wealthy who simply inherited large fortunes they never labored for. This natural phenomenon also has a parallel in the spirit realm. Only he that gathereth by labor is permitted to increase. What is this labor? Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him has God the Father sealed. Then said they unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God, that ye believe on him whom he has sent. John 6 verse 27 to 29. This is a call to labor, to stand on the word of God in spite of the events, contrary circumstances and opposition. Labor to stand on the word. This is the labor God has commissioned you into. Labor for the word of God to be effectual in your life. Give it what it takes to stand on the word, by the word, and for the word. In 1 Timothy 5 verse 17, the Bible says, let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. This is referring to those who walk the walk of God, that is, those who do and see that the word of God is carried out as commanded. God says, count them of double honor. It takes covenant exercises to become a kingdom high flyer. As long as you remain a collector, you die a beggar. It is time to exercise yourself unto the covenant to bring out the star in you in the times of famine. The covenant works. The covenant distinguishes. Let us look at how four characters in the Bible pass through hardship without feeling its pinch and why they were distinguished. Abraham. And there was famine in the land, and Abraham went down into Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was grievous in the land. Genesis 12 verse 10. And Abraham went up out of Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot with him, into the south. And Abraham was very very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. Genesis 13, verse 1 to 2. In spite of the hardship, God provided a way out for Abraham. The Bible says the famine was very grievous, but it also goes on to say that at the end of the day, Abraham was very rich. Is that not a paradox? Friend, you serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You do not have to die a victim. There is a way out for you, Isaac. There was famine in the land. King and subjects alike were affected. The famine was severe in the land. King Abimelech and all his experts saw no way out in sight. The ground was as hard as a rock. There was no sign of rain in the near future. And there was a famine in the land besides the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. Genesis 26 verse 1. In the same land lived a man called Isaac. He was a covenant son of God, a bona fide son of Abraham. He looked at the situation and his first reaction was to flee. Egypt is the answer, he thought. But God said to him, go not down into Egypt. Dwell in the land which I shall tell thee of. Sojourn in this land, and I will be with thee and bless thee. Genesis 26 verse 2 to 3. Isaac heard the word of God and obeyed. He remained in the land of the Philistines, but the situation did not change. Then he remembered the covenant. I must sow some good seed, he said to himself. But the conditions are terrible. The ground is so hard. Can any seed survive in this soil without rain in sight? He wondered. All the same, Isaac sowed in the land. It was one of the most difficult and painful experiences of his life, but God blessed the seed. Then Isaac sowed in that land and received in the same year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. Genesis 26 verse 12. Isaac, despite the famine, he sowed in the land and received in that same year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. And the man waxed great and went forward and grew until he became very great. Genesis 26 verse 13. Isaac, the son of Abraham, did not become great because of Abraham's wealth. He did not become great because God has said he would bless him. He would have perished like the Philistines, even though God had spoken to him, if he had eaten of the seed. He became great because he operated God's covenant of abundance. He despised the climate, operated the covenant, and escaped the humiliation in the land. The covenant works. Besides, Isaac also had a store of servants, each one handling a specific duty. The one that carried water was different from the one that cleaned the shoes, and the one that cooked the meals was different from the one that dried, cleaned the clothes. You will be exempted from this great tension that has come upon the earth. You will not know that it exists. It is interesting to walk in the covenant. The Bible says in the book of Galatians 4 verse 28, now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. Abraham and Isaac experienced famine. I do not know why you think you should not, but as we keep on obeying the law of abundance, we shall be distinguished. Isaac received that same year a hundredfold return. Everybody was mocking him. There was no rain, so he had to break the hard ground. But because you can't break the covenant, God honored his covenant sense. In spite of this hardship, God will distinguish you. Never mind the environment, rather mind the instructions from heaven, and you can never be stranded or become a victim. Isaac became the envy of the Philistines. I say by word of prophecy that as you walk in the covenant, you shall be the envy of your countrymen. By the grace of God, I am not indebted to any man, dead or alive. I have not had to borrow from any bank once for any reason whatsoever. The end has come to all tensions in your finances. Jacob. When Jacob heard that there was grain in Egypt, he said to his sons, get you down there and buy for us from thence. Genesis 42 verse 2. He did not say, get ye down there and beg for us. No, in spite of the famine, Jacob had means. In spite of the impending hardship, hardship, you will not lack means. No matter the degree of hardship, you and your children will never beg. Joseph's brethren had the means to buy grain. In the time of famine, Jacob had the best fruits in the land in his house. And their father Israel said unto them, if it must be so, now do this. Take all the best fruits in the land in your vessels and carry down to the man a present. Genesis 43 verse 11. Fruits are usually taken as dessert. In times of famine, do people talk about desserts? Yet nuts, almonds, myrrh were in the house of Jacob in the time of famine. He had all these in abundance while the famine was very sore. A look at Genesis 43:12 shows that the money in the sack held no attraction to Jacob. And take double money in your hand, and the money that was brought again in the mouth of the sacks, carry it again in your hand. Peradventure, it was an oversight. There is a level of lifting you experience in God that makes nothing in the world hold any attraction to you any longer. While some Christians are struggling to take bribes, Jacob was rejecting gifts. He gave his children double bundles of money plus the other bundle they had on them, making three bundles per person. As the famine was heightening, Jacob's sufficiency were increasing. Since inflation had caught up with supplies, he had to carry double money. Prices had increased by 100%, yet Jacob was not moved. You will never beg. And the man took that present, and they took double money in their hand, and Benjamin, and rose up and went down to Egypt and stood before Joseph. Genesis 43:15. While others are hiding, you will stand out. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob saw famine. It is no strange thing if there is famine in our days. Abraham overcame. Isaac became the envy of the Philistines. And Jacob had no attraction for anything outside what God gave him. He was able to rise with the inflation and buy at any cost. While things are going up, you too need to go up so you won't feel what is going on around you. Joseph, never mind where you are now. Joseph was in prison, and overnight he was in the palace. God is lifting you up into a new realm. You will become a supplier of the needs of the people. God has not changed. Isaac was a stranger in the land of the Philistines, and he became an envy in their land. And the 7 years of plenteousness that was in the land of Egypt were ended, and the 7 years of dearth began to come. Genesis 41:53-54. The years of dearth don't come overnight. They begin to come. And the famine was over all the face of the earth. And Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold unto the Egyptians. And the famine waxed sore in the land of Egypt. Genesis 41:56. Today, Jesus is our Joseph. He came before us to prepare a way for us. Other examples. Again, there was a widow who had two sons. Her husband was a prophet of God, but he died leaving a great debt behind. The woman was being harassed and she risked losing her two sons. She ran to Elisha, having heard proving testimonies of his access to God. The man of God looked at her and asked her a question. What hast thou in the house? 2 Kings 4 verse 2. The woman wondered what kind of question this was. Nothing, she answered. Then the man of God must have said, if you have nothing, then there is nothing I can do to help you. The woman knew she had a pot of oil reserved, but it was a very precious commodity to her. She was hiding it from everyone. It was her last resource. Or when she offered it, the word of the Lord, which guaranteed her freedom from death, came. She obeyed the word and her abundance was released. She paid off her debt and had excess with which to live. believe. 2 Kings 4, 1 to 7. You can be a man of God and be neck deep in debt. Your way out of predicament is operating the covenant. When the covenant is operated, mysterious forces are set in motion to cause your blessings to come, exceeding and abundantly more than you asked or thought. There was a time we needed baby food in our home. It was a period of great scarcity in the land. Basic food items were very difficult to come by, even when you had the money. Every day, there were long queues at supermarkets and government distribution centers. One could queue for a week without getting anything. I didn't have the time for all that. I was going about my business, God's business. My wife came home one day with her monthly salary. As she brought it home, the Lord told me to give it as a seed, which I did. The following Sunday, someone drove to our home with 24 cartons of baby food. 24 cartons, not tins. I operated the covenant. When God called Abraham, he said, "If you do what I tell you, I will bless you and you will become a blessing to others." There was yet another widow who miraculously survived famine in the Old Testament. The widow of Zarephath was in a most pitiable condition, but she gave what she had to Elijah the prophet, and she was blessed with abundance. You too can escape famine. You can escape lack and demotion. You can escape every hardship coming upon the earth. God has given you the power. Use it to your advantage. Rest by the covenant. If there is any rest you need today, it is in the area of finance. The noise and the rattling keep announcing greater uncertainty. The economic policies have several loopholes that can never be filled. The global economic system is crashing down before our eyes. If there is anywhere we need to enter into, it is His rest. There is how to contact the rest of God. And the Spirit of God came upon Azariah the son of Oded, and he went out to meet Asa and said unto him, "Hear ye me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin. The Lord is with you while ye be with him. And if ye seek him, he will be found of you. But if ye forsake him, he will forsake you." Now, for a long season, Israel has been without the true God and without a teaching priest and without law. 2 Chronicles 15 verse 1 to 3. When you are without law, you remain low. God is a strategist. He is not an ordinary God. He knows what he wants. And in those days, there was no peace to him that went out, nor to him that came in. But great vexations were upon all the inhabitants of the countries. 2 Chronicles 15, verse 5. Seeking the Lord is work and not fun. It is time to believe God in order to renew the altar of your life. So they gathered themselves together at Jerusalem in the third month, in the 15th year of the reign of Asa, and they offered unto the Lord the same time of the spoil which they had brought, 700 oxen and 7,000 sheep. And they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord God of their fathers with all their heart and with all their soul, that whosoever would not seek the Lord God of Israel should be put to death, whether small or great, whether man or woman. And they swore unto the Lord with a loud voice, and with shouting, and with trumpets and with cornets. And all Judah rejoiced at the oath, for they had sworn with all their heart, and sought him with their whole desire, and he was found of them. And the Lord gave them rest round about. 2 Chronicles 15, verse 10 to 15. Friends, you will contact rest round about. Rest at home, rest over your children, rest over your body, rest over your soul. He gave them rest in all of life. And there was no more war until the 35th year of the reign of Asa. 2 Chronicles 15 verse 19. For 20 whole years, Asa lived in the covenant boom. "Return unto me, and I will return unto you, saith the Lord of hosts." Malachi 3 verse 7. Financial hardship comes your way when you walk away from the covenant. When the covenant no longer makes meaning to you, you enter into financial hardship with your eyes wide open. For 15 whole years, Israel had no rest. But when they entered into a covenant with God, everything turned around. The covenant walk is the sweetest adventure in life. I don't get excited when people give me things. Rather, I'm excited when I am able to give out. I have been taught by the Holy Ghost that my supply is dependent on my giving and not on my receiving. Jesus, the great shepherd, never turned to any man for help. Friend, it is time to concentrate on the kingdom perspective of financial management. It works. Somebody once asked me, "Sir, I want to know, is your financial blessings from books or tapes?" I asked him whether he wanted to know the truth, and he said yes. I told him that I am yet to receive the first 1 naira as royalty from all the books I have been privileged to author since 1985. Yet they are selling at home and abroad. As long as money is your focus, you will mourn. Money is a speed machine. No one who chases it ever catches up with it. But when you are a God seeker, goodness and mercy will be running after you. This is the truth. It works any day, anytime. How? God says He is the one that will add it to you. Friend, I would like you to know that God is no respecter of persons. How long you have been doing what you are doing is not important. It is how well you have been doing it that matters. The work to make you enter into your rest was finished before the foundation of the earth. God has finished His part, leaving you and I to do ours. It is time to cease from struggles and enter into the rest that is prepared for you. Hebrews 4 verse 1 to 12. Verses 11 and 12 suggests that we labor to do what the word demands. Give yourself over to the demands of His word and you will enter into His rest. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same kind of unbelief. Hebrews 4 verse 11. Chapter 3, The Carpenters. Then lifted I up mine eyes, and saw, and behold, four horns. And I said unto the angel that talked with me, "What be these?" And he answered me, "These are the horns which have scattered Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem. And the Lord shewed me four carpenters." Then said I, "What come these to do?" And he spake, saying, "These are the horns which have scattered Judah, so that no man did lift up his head, but these are come to fray them, to cast out the horns of the Gentiles, which lifted up their horn over the land of Judah to scatter it." Zechariah 1 verse 18 to 21. The horns in this scripture represent the acts of the wicked. The horns were there to scatter the people, so that none of them is able to raise his head. Hitherto, the devil had loaded the church with dangerous doctrines that terminate in mediocrity. All that people had to show for their Christianity were pious looks. The saying, "as poor as church rats," was a common adage. The church became a committee of humiliated men. Consequently, everybody despised and began to look at the church with pity. Every time God wants to bring about a change, He raises men to scatter what the devil is doing. The carpenters here are human instruments who have come to terrify the horns. God sent me. Moreover, He called for a famine upon the land. He broke the whole staff of bread. He sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with fetters. He was laid in iron. Until the time that his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. The king sent and loosed him, even the ruler of the people, and let him go free. He made him lord of his house and ruler of all his substance, to bind his princes at his pleasure and teach his senators wisdom. Israel also came into Egypt And Jacob sojourned in the land of Ham, and he increased his people greatly and made them stronger than their enemies. Psalm 105, verse 16 to 24. Every time calamity is at the door, God sends tried, tested, and proven people for the purpose of redeeming his own people. Joseph said, God sent me here to preserve life. You thought you sent me? No, God sent me here. God says, I am the Lord, I change not. Every time there was an impending calamity, God had always prepared people whom he sent for the rescue of his people to preserve them in famine. The Bible says, Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy, to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive in famine. Psalm 33, verse 18 to 19. The Lord knoweth the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. They shall not be ashamed in the evil time, and in the days of famine they shall be satisfied. Psalm 37, verse 18 to 19. God will always send whosoever he wills for the rescue of his people. With all humility, I boldly tell you that God sent me to preserve life, because a whole staff of bread is breaking before our very eyes. I remember very clearly in 1987, I was in the United States of America for a meeting, when the Lord said to me, Get down home quick and make my people rich. They were very strong, compelling, and powerful words. So I abandoned everything I was doing, canceled all my engagements, and rushed down home immediately. God showed me something from 2 Corinthians 6 verse 10. As poor, yet making many rich. As having nothing, and yet possessing all things. This scripture gave me courage. The Lord told me, even though you don't look rich, just go and do what I say you should do. No matter how you look, just go and do what I say. I will prove it. Friends, God sent me for your rescue, so that you might be preserved in this impending great famine, i.e. this global economic recession. I do believe that you are going to partake of the fullness of this commission. You must diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord your God and observe to do whatever he commands you through my mouth. Then the Lord your God will set you on high above all nations of the earth. It is your God that will set you up. No devil can challenge him. When God stretches forth his hand, who can turn it back? When he lifts up, who can let down? The Bible says, Believe in the Lord your God, so shall ye be established. Believe his prophets, so shall ye prosper. 2 Chronicles 20 verse 20. Who confirmeth the word of his servant, and performeth the counsel of his messengers. Isaiah 44 verse 25. You are not programmed to partake in this famine. You are not destined to be a victim. When Jesus came, he knew his commission and declared it very clearly. I say this over and over again. God sent me. He said, Go and make my people rich. That is an assurance that wherever I stand, poverty must not survive. Not because I am anything in myself, but because there is a commission that God is committed to back up. That is the reason we shed tears of joy when we see things happen, because they don't come of human strength, but out of a divine backup. How is it that hands are laid on somebody's head and everything about him just experiences a turnaround? It has nothing to do with the hand. It is God backing up the commission. Poverty is not permitted to survive wherever this commission is represented. Recently, I was in Ethiopia for a seminar. The Holy Ghost spoke to me that there was a plague of poverty upon the nation. When I got to Ethiopia, I anointed the ground. I cursed poverty there, and then I said, Begin from the church, Lord. Turn the destiny of this nation. After I taught the people, God wants you to prosper. Stop seeing yourself as poor. The offering multiplied by three. Friend, I was under an obligation to declare to you what the voice of the Lord has spoken to me. I'm here for a revolution. We are not here trying to minister to people. We are here to establish a turnaround for them. In Zechariah 1 verse 17, God said, cry yet saying, thus saith the Lord of hosts, my cities through prosperity shall yet be spread abroad. Now that he has commissioned us to spread abroad, it is a proof that he has destined us to prosper. What you will begin to experience as you anchor your faith on this commission will make you a surprise to yourself. Like the carpenters mentioned in Zechariah 1 verse 21, this ministry is a terror to the kingdom of darkness. Sometime last year, someone in the occult got saved in our church in Ibadan. Few days before then, God had shown him a church in his dream and told him that there he would be given a gift. On his way to visit his family some days later, his car broke down right in front of the church's signpost on the expressway. As he looked at the signpost, it struck him that that was the same church shown him in his dream. He set out in search of the church. After 3 discouraging hours, he found the place, went in just as the tail end of the service and gave his life to Christ. Other members of the cult which he belonged to in Lagos later called him to threaten him for humiliating us before these Jesus people. After he got saved, he had told the pastor all that he had in his house, all his altars and occultic junk. The pastor told him to anoint where he kept all those things. A few days later, his house caught fire and only the anointed place where the junk were kept got burnt. The occult people got so enraged and built a ritual coffin for him. They called him and said to him, in 3 days' time, you'll be a dead man. He boldly said to them, the God of Bishop Oyedepo shall fight you. The coffin you have built for me, you shall be buried in it. 2 days later, the head of the occultic group died mysteriously. Friend, there are God's carpenters on earth. Their mission is to terrify the wicked and stop them from oppressing the innocent. Friend, power past power. I am glad to let you know that there is no witch or wizard that can overturn your destiny in God. As long as you take the things that God is speaking to you through me seriously, we are here to stop the devil. The richest man in this nation will come out of the church. This is because I am sent by God with this commission, and the husbandman that laboreth must be first partaker of the fruits. 2 Timothy 2 verse 6. As long as you labor to follow the dictates of this commission, you will be the first partaker of the fruits. I am glad to tell you that the four carpenters are for the four corners of the world. We have men commissioned to terrify the kingdom of darkness and rescue God's people from bondage. Men sent by God to stop the pharaohs of this world and say to the Red Sea, enough is enough. That is what we are doing. You must erase the mentality that the enemy is responsible for your not going forward. A woman testified that she anointed her house, and when fire came, it could not engulf the place. It was the power of God that quenched the fire. I have said all this to establish your liberty. It is not possible for the enemy to stop you when you are under the ministry of the carpenters. The time for the open manifestation of the sons of God is here. Malachi 3 verse 18 says, then shall ye return and discern between the righteous and the wicked, between him that serveth God and him that serveth him not. It is happening already. Now is the time when the world will begin to envy the church. It has begun already. What the world struggles to touch, we don't even give a thought to get, nor do we even lift a finger before it comes. That is the reason they will come to us and say, teach us his ways and we will walk in his path. I am sent for your rescue. not because I'm better than you are. I'm only commissioned to do what I am doing. Whatever God has commissioned, He is committed to perform. We are in the midst of a commission that represents plenty. We have no part with lack. God has sent me like He sent Joseph to preserve life in a time when destruction has become imminent and finances are holding multitudes captive. No one under this ministry is permitted to be poor, nor programmed for affliction. God told me, "Go and stop the tears of mankind." I heard Him very well. God sent me for your financial rescue. Every church where I have ever ministered, whether I teach healing or minister on divine protection, by the mystery of this commission, such churches flourish. Come into the grand design of God for escape. God has marked out a strategy for escape. The prophet Elijah visited the widow of Zarephath. He told her, "I bring you a way of escape. Make for me first what you wanted to make for you and your son, and you will never lack throughout this famine." She embraced this way of escape and entered into the ark of mysterious supplies. God's program for man is always executed by men whose faithfulness have been proved by God in the particular area for which the men have been sent. I am sent for your rescue. Chapter 4, Your Access to Financial Liberty. Service. As long as you live unto yourself, you give yourself unto the enemy. But when you live unto God, no devil can touch you. Listen to this. Satan came to God the Father and said, "Doth Job serve God for naught?" Job 1 verse 9. From this, we see that whatever Job became, it was true service. The Bible said, Job became the greatest man in all the East. How did he get there? It was through the mysterious ladder of service. Serving God is profitable. If you are set to serve, God is set to free you from every bondage and slavery, be it financial, spiritual, or physical. Exodus 4 verse 22-23. Until God becomes the center of your life, everything keeps falling apart. Until you are ready for God, you are not ready for good. Serving God is your insurance against bondage, lack, shame, and penury. Your commitment to God will provoke heaven's commitment to you. Friend, your liberty is tied to your readiness to serve Him. Those who are willing to serve Him, He is set to free. If you must be free, it must be to serve Him, not just for the sake of freedom, but to be a part of the kingdom program on earth. The time has come when God wants to show to the whole world that serving Him is profitable. He wants the whole world to see that following Him and His ways is the most profitable venture on earth. When you are genuinely committed to the service of the Lord, you have the potential of being the greatest man in your generation. There is a secret ladder people climb. If you can locate that ladder, you are committed to climbing it. You will take off in the air. When you are unreservedly sold out for God, you will be distinguished in your generation. It is time to despise money and exalt God. Be consumed with God, not with your business. If you carry God high, the way you carry that business of yours, you will be transformed to a high-flying eagle today. When you do the right thing with your 10 naira, it will become 100 naira. When you do the right thing with your 100 naira, it will become 1,000 naira. And when you do the right thing with your 1,000 naira, it will become 10,000 naira. And when you do the right thing with your 10,000 naira, it will become 100,000 naira. By the time you do the right thing with your 100,000 naira, it will become 1 million naira. Do the right thing with 1 million naira, and it is on its way to becoming 1 billion naira. That is the way it works. You do not need prayer of agreement for this. All you need is to agree with yourself to serve God. Take on a new heart. Acquaint not thyself with him, and be at peace. Thereby good shall come unto thee. Receive, I pray thee, the law from his mouth, and lay off his words in thine heart. If thou return to the Almighty, thou shalt be built up. Thou shalt put away iniquity far from thy tabernacles. Then shalt thou lay up gold as dust, and the gold of Ophir as the stones of the brooks. Yea, the Almighty shall be thy defense, and thou shalt have plenty of silver. Job 22:21-25. There is a pathway to plenty. You have to return to the Almighty. God said to me, tell them your secret and leave them to make decisions. I would like you this day to enter into a covenant to seek the Lord with the whole of your heart and desire. When that is in place, you will no longer be a beggar on the earth. Stop living for things. Start living for God. The enemy is out to contest your destiny. Unlike Esau, do not sell your birthright. Your birthright is so glorious. It is so enviable. Do not give it out. You were in Jacob when God prophesied his destiny, that the elder shall serve the younger. Jacob was the younger and Esau was the elder. The unredeemed world in Adam is the elder brother of the redeemed world in Jesus. By destiny, therefore, the unredeemed world is to serve the redeemed world. But there is a secret to it. If you must multiply, it is by consecrated and committed service. If you must have rest roundabout, give your heart to him today so that your heartbeat will be towards heaven. Your destiny is in your hands. Satan will negotiate your commitment. When the Israelites wanted to go, Pharaoh's heart began to weaken. He said to Moses in Exodus 8:28, I will let you go, that ye may sacrifice to the Lord your God in the wilderness. Only ye shall not go very far away. Satan is out to negotiate your liberty by advocating a moderate Christianity. He can't stand the truth, and he knows that your destiny is anchored on your commitment. Once he can negotiate your moderate commitment, he has made you a mediocrity. Your destiny anchors on your commitment to God, not on your energy and sweat. I have proved this truth in my own life. I have watched God promote me to higher grounds as I committed myself the more to his kingdom work. The quality of your commitment determines the quality of your destiny. What could negotiate the commitment of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? They took their lives in their hands and went into the fire. Howbeit, they didn't come out of it the same. They came out of the fire as rulers. The king could not negotiate Daniel's commitment. He, Daniel, was not afraid of being thrown into the lion's den for praying to his God. He came out of that den the most honorable man in the whole world. Satan is out against your destiny, and until he can cut down your commitment, he can't tamper with your future. Be ready to serve God with your treasures too. Again, in Exodus 10:11, Pharaoh said, not so. Go now, ye that are men, and serve the Lord. In verse 24, he came again with another proposition. Go ye, serve the Lord. Only let your flocks and your herds be stayed. There are many that are serving God with all their hearts, but without their purses. That is the devil's last negotiation. But Moses said, our cattle also shall go with us. There shall not an hoof be left behind. For thereof must we take to serve the Lord our God. And we know not with what we must serve the Lord until we come thither. Exodus 10 verse 26. Satan was negotiating their serving God with their treasures. That was the final test of their readiness to serve God. Your treasures are your substance of worship. Your platform for freedom is your readiness to serve God with all that you are and all that you have. When you give yourself over to God, the difficulties of your life will come to an end. You will keep smiling all the days of your life. Those who do not serve God will end up serving men. They will dance to the tune of men because they refuse to dance to God's tune. I have never begged any mortal man for anything since I came into the ministry. Those who serve God don't beg men. The dread of them is upon every man. Until you are committed to serving God, you will keep serving men and circumstances all the days of your life. Serving God with all that you are and all that you have qualifies you for all that God has, and all that God has is more than enough for your life. Your best qualifies you for God's best, and God's best is more than enough for you. Don't let Satan put the Egyptian mark on you. I mean the taskmaster's mark, the mark of slavery and poverty. Refuse his negotiations. When you truly begin to look for God, you will not look for other things before they are added to you. An unreserved, uncompromising commitment will put you into the struggle-free zone of life. Anyone who cannot give his money cannot give his body. Anybody can dream in the night and say God called him. But if you cannot give your means, you are not a candidate for giving your life. You are a self-deceiver. God cannot, for example, call someone who does not pay his tithe to come and pay his life. In Job 36 verse 11, he said, "If they will obey and serve me, they will spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasures." Will you obey and serve him today? There are many whose offering was 10 naira 5 years ago. God has multiplied them 20 times over, and yet their offering remains permanently at 10 naira. All they are waiting for is for God to come and reduce them. If you will not serve God with your means, you will end up serving your means. Those who refuse to place their gold in the temple will turn them to idols. Don't let the blessing upon your life become a curse. It is time to place kingdom budgets as priority over your own budgets. Worship God with your means and free yourself from the tension of the hour. The life of the tight-fisted man is high temperature. Kingdom addiction. "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Matthew 6:33. This is the big bang that will grant you eternal access into sweatless supplies. God is saying, with the same zest and vigor that the Gentiles are using to pursue money, pursue my kingdom, and I will add unto you all those things they are running after. This was my liberating scripture. It turned my life around. As long as you are contributing to the tensions of other people, you are sowing a seed. You too will not be free from tension. Whatsoever a man sows, that he shall reap. God is not mocked. What some people call business is imprisonment. Doctors giving people drugs that do not have any relevance to the sickness, just to collect their money. Friends, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven. He did not give us two things to seek after before other things shall be added. I am only doing kingdom covenant business. Have you not heard that whosoever will not work should not eat? Giving is not an activity, it is a work. Only those who take it as a work, eat by it. It is neither a hobby nor a religious activity. David said, now I have prepared with all my might for the house of my God. 1 Chronicles 29 verse 2. Kingdom addiction establishes covenant distinction. I have seen the reality of the booties of the covenant. This energizes my spirit man to walk in the covenant. The Bible says, by much slothfulness the building decayeth, and through idleness of the hands the house droppeth through. Ecclesiastes 10 verse 18. You do not watch your destiny decay. It is time to walk. The time has come for you to walk out into eternal financial liberty. If only you will concentrate your might and desire on the house of God. There is no man whose might and desire are on God who will not have his own proper good. David said, the house of my God. As far as he was concerned, it was his own house. The 3,000 talents of gold of Ophir that he gave represents $576 million, while the 7,000 talents of silver represent $56,960,000. All this came out of one man's proper good. He said, I have of mine own proper goods of gold and silver, which I have given to the house of my God. These things are written for our example. How did David contact that level of wealth? He said, with all my might I have prepared for the house of my God, and with all my affection I am focusing on his house. These were his own personal gifts. Friend, God will cause you to blossom like the palm tree. He will cause you to grow like the cedar in Lebanon. The only business that gave David his proper goods was kingdom addiction. Make all your might available for the lifting of his kingdom. When you are serving God, there are certain things that money cannot buy that come your way. He blesses your bread and your water. That means it never finishes. It takes sicknesses away from you. He sees to it that you are neither barren nor cast your young in the land. He fulfills the number of your days. Exodus 23 verse 25 to 26. There is no drug for long life. There is no drug for divine health. It has its source in God. That is what you get when you are giving up to God. There is a future for you, but you need a correct heart to get there. If God can trust you on what you vow on any business that comes your way, he will make sure that businesses don't stop coming your way. Do you know why many people make vows and yet don't get anything? They say, oh God, 50% of every profit I make from today goes to your kingdom. I mean it, but God can't trust them. He has checked their hearts and he knows they will not do it. Hannah said to God, give me a man child and I will give him back to you. God said, is that right? He checked her heart and it was correct, and he gave her a man child. 1 Samuel 1 verse 20. She kept her vow, and God pursued after her with more honorable sons coming out of the same womb. May God be able to trust you. Sacrifice. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, whereof we are glad. Psalm 126 verse 1 to 3. Nothing turns financial captivity around like sacrifice. Daniel was constantly sacrificing and God kept on turning his captivity. Sacrifice is the master key that turns the captivity of people's finances any day, anytime. It is the key. God has programmed to bring you into a financial dreamland. This is the hour that your captivity must be turned. All the sinners in your home and neighborhood will know that something has happened to you. A gentleman came into our church premises. He was a Muslim. He had watched his neighbor, a member of our church, who could not get food to eat before, now buying land. He then said to himself, something must be happening in that church. Again, he saw another couple who came to our church jobless, and not long after, the wife suddenly got a job. Suddenly also, the husband began to do one thing or the other, and then bought a Mercedes-Benz car. This Muslim man then decided, I will go there. The word of God says in Psalm 126 verse 2, then said they among the heathen, the Lord has done great things for them. The time has come for the Lord to turn your captivity like the streams in the south. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. Psalm 126 verse 5 to 6. This is sacrifice. The secret is sow in tears, and no devil can stop you from reaping in joy. There is nothing that you plant in the kingdom for which you will not receive manifold more now in this life. This year will not pass before you become the envy of your countrymen. The covenant will prevail in your life. Gather my saints together unto me, those who have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. Psalm 50 verse 5. Covenants are made by sacrifice. In his book, Sowing in Famine, a man of God, Jerry Savley, said, when God revealed these things to me in October 1981, we had tremendous needs in our ministry. We were building and expanding, and more money was needed. We had to keep our faith on the job continually. I had gotten to a point where I was fed up with the devil contending for my finances. After all, God said he would command his blessings upon me, rebuke the devourers for my sake, and bring to me hundredfold returns that same year. My wife and I agreed we would sow in famine, as Isaac did in Genesis 26 verse 12 to 14. And God would give us a hundredfold return that same year. So we wrote out 10 checks of $1,000 each for each of the 10 major areas of our ministry. I needed a big and faster airplane to travel to all our meetings. So we also sold $1,000 for that. Caroline and I sold $1,000 personally as well. Altogether, checks totaling $11,000 were written. In the natural, it looked foolish to give away $11,000. But God had told me that when I sow in famine, he will command his blessings upon me. After writing the checks, we sowed them into the ministries as God had instructed us. The same day, God blessed us with a seed of $10,000. I sowed in famine, and the next week I was given a $150,000 airplane. That same week, I received another check of $100,000. Friends, sacrifice will bring you outstanding and instantaneous turnarounds. Put away the idols. Is there anything around your life that God cannot touch? That is an idol. It is your disqualifier. Whatever God cannot touch in your life for the promotion of his kingdom is an altar that must be destroyed. It is an idol in the group of Macha, the mother of Asa. It must go or you go. You must make your choice. Nothing else is worth living and dying for but Jesus. Any desire you have that becomes a contract when you say, God, if you don't do this, I will go. God will not do it. You can neither increase nor reduce God. Enter into a covenant with God. I want you to contact the easy life that Jesus has offered us. I want you to experience it. I want you to stay on it. And they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord God of their fathers with all their heart and with all soul. 2 Chronicles 15:12. Will you enter into a covenant with God to be the best in his service? Will you make your best available to his service at all times and at any moment? When God called me and there was pressure on me not to heed, I said to God, should I pretend not to have heard you? See that I don't succeed in any other thing I do. When you serve him, it is to prove you for what next place to put you. He said to Abraham, for now I know that thou fearest God. In blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Genesis 22:12-18. You are a king. If you die a slave, you are to be blamed. Service is the highway of kings. It is the royal expressway. It will guarantee your liberty. And they swore unto the Lord with a loud voice, and with shouting, and with trumpets, and with cornets. And all Judah rejoiced at the oath. 2 Chronicles 15:14-15. May you come under the arrest of commitment, the one you will never be free from all the days of your life. It will guarantee your liberty eternally. Obedience to his word. You are meant to escape the financial holocaust coming upon the earth. You are not expected to fall when sinners are falling. There is a great hardship coming upon the world, but God has created an escape route for you. You have a way out. He said, there has no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. 1 Corinthians 10:13. There is a way to escape in God. You can count on God's faithfulness. Your way out of financial predicament and embarrassment is by responding to the infallible word of God. If you must be named among the stars this end time, then you must react promptly and positively to the word of God. God's word is going to be the only authentic lifting force in the world. Your sweat and toil will not lift you. The word sweat connotes struggle, survival of the fittest. Your expertise and strength will all be in vain. Only your positive response to the word of God will shoot you up to triumphant living. Jesus came and he said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. John 6:63. The words of God are living forces. They are the most powerful living forces at work in the world today, and will soon become the only proven forces at work on earth. All sinners shall run to them. Responding to the living words of God is the only way you can enjoy the blessings of God. Peter was a highly experienced fisherman. He had everything going for him. He had the strength of an ox. His experience and expertise as a fisherman was well acknowledged. He was bold and fearless. He went fishing under the best fishing conditions, but all this could not get him even a shrimp. He put all his fishing techniques to work, but the Bible tells us that he caught nothing. His expertise could not help him. His toiling was all in vain. Then the word of God came. Launch out into the deep and let down your net for a draught. Luke 5 verse 4. Here was Peter, a frustrated fisherman. He had just returned from a very disappointing fishing trip. He had washed his nets. All he wanted was to get back home and recount his tale of woe to his wife. But then an order was released. He sized up the one who gave the order and came to the conclusion that he doesn't speak idle words. How did he know this? The man Jesus had just finished holding a crusade on the seashore using Peter's empty boat as his platform. Peter had heard the graceful words which flowed from his lips, piercing the hearts of his listeners. Peter acknowledged, "This man speaks no idle words, but before I obey, I must explain my predicament to him." So he said, "Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net." Luke 5 verse 5. Peter decided to switch over from toiling to the word. Professional fishermen always go fishing at night. But here was a man telling the greatest expert of them all to let down his fishing net in broad daylight. Stupid? Yes. Crazy? Of course. With all the facts available, it seemed impossible for Peter to catch any fish at that time of the day. But there is something greater than all these established facts. It is the living word of God. At the release of God's word, every contrary situation fades away to pave the way for the manifestation of the word. Peter recognized this. I'm sure he must have been a bit shaky about it, but he was determined to obey the word which had been released. He obeyed the word and caught more fish than he had ever done in all his fishing experience. Obedience to God's word bailed Peter out of his predicament. Obedience still remains the principal instrument that will rescue any sinking saint out of the waters of uncertainty. The same way that God's word prevailed contrary to all fishing laws, so also will it prevail contrary to all the economic laws of the times. Whatever he tells you to do, Jesus and his disciples were invited to a marriage feast one day. It was a very joyous occasion. The mother of Jesus was there too. Everything was going on fine. Then the enemy struck. Darkness loomed. The supply of wine was exhausted, but all the wedding plans had been sufficient to entertain the crowd. Things, however, went contrary to expectations. The bridegroom was perplexed. Shame was imminent. He had invited Jesus and his disciples to the feast, but he didn't know where to go for a solution. Thank God for Mary, the mother of Jesus. She was involved and she knew where to turn. She first turned to the word and later went to the servants and said, "Stay by this man. Whatever he tells you to do, do it without asking questions. Do not move away until he tells you what to do." Mary provoked the word. She stirred the waters and the word was released. Fill the water pot with water. John 2 verse 7. When they were filled, Jesus said, "Draw out now and bear unto the governor of the feast." John 2 verse 8. What an instruction. But the servants obeyed, and the blessings of God were released. Shame was driven away. Shame is imminent for the world. Only obedience will lead to abundance. Obedience releases the blessings of God packaged in the word. If you do whatsoever God says you should do, you will experience what he has promised. God is no respecter of persons. In any nation, anyone who fears him and works righteousness is accepted with him. Acts 10 verse 34 to 35. The Bible says the proud and the wicked are put together. That means that the proud Christians who disregards God's word will suffer the same calamity that the unbelievers are going to suffer. May you never have your portion with the wicked. In this kingdom, you only make it by truth. There is no other way to deal with darkness outside of light. In the same way, there is no other way to deal with hardship but by the knowledge and practice of the truth. There are many who that have some knowledge of certain things, but not all that have the knowledge practice that knowledge. It is the practice of the truth that equals success. He says, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments. Deuteronomy 28 verse 1. To observe means to check through the notes, to try to find out what it exactly means, and to do. Then the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body and the fruit of thy ground. Thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. And the Lord shall make thee the head and not the tail. And thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath. Deuteronomy 28 verse 1 to 13. When you have received and applied the word, you must succeed. Until you joyfully receive the word and forcefully apply and practice it, success is not in view. That is the key. If you are keyless, you are a self-prisoner. There is no method or amount of muscles that can get you through a locked door without the key. It takes the key to gain access to the realm of sweatless success. It is the same key that guaranteed Jesus a sweatless success all through his earthly ministry. Consequently, he was always unruffled. When he was told that Lazarus, his friend, was dead, he said, "But I go that I may awake him out of sleep." John 11 verse 11. When he was faced with the feeding of 5,000 people, he simply lifted the 5 loaves and 2 fishes up to heaven and gave thanks. And that great multitude was fed with 12 full baskets gathered as leftover. He has the keys, so he just manifests his sonship. May the Lord place the keys in your hand. Struggle will not cease until you contact the truth that relates to that area of struggle. Some degree of light has come my way that makes sickness subservient. It must obey when told what to do. If we join the world in the struggle for survival, we will feel the way they feel. The knowledge and the practice of the truth makes you a sweatless winner. They open every prison house that has locked you in. It takes knowledge to become free from sweat. Not all winners sweat to win. Sweating is a curse. It symbolizes struggles. Until you go for the truth and practice it, your freedom is not in view. The struggle continues. Only the blessings of God can make rich. It is the blessings of God that make rich without adding any sorrow. They are released through obedience. Your expertise will not make rich. Your sweat and toil will all be in vain. For except the Lord blesses you, you cannot be blessed. The word confirms this. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he giveth his beloved sleep. Psalm 127, verse 1 to 2. There is good in the land, but it is for those who will be willing and obedient. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. Isaiah 1, verse 19. The only way you can escape the frustration and undue hardship coming upon the world is by obeying the word of God. Everyone standing on the word will experience the supernatural confirmation of it. Acquaint now thyself with him and be at peace. Thereby God shall come unto thee. Receive, I pray thee, the law from his mouth, and lay up his words in thine heart. If thou return to the Almighty, thou shalt be built up. Thou shalt put away iniquity far from thy tabernacles. Then shalt thou lay up gold as dust, and the gold of Ophir as the stones of the brook. Job 22, verse 21 to 24. God's word is your access to abundance and plenty in the time of lack and want. Lay hold on it and do what it says. Get connected to the source. There is a war-free zone in Christianity. There is a lack-free zone in redemption. There is an all-round triumph zone in Zion. You must find it. You must apply yourself to it before you can stand inside it. Whatever you are looking for and you have not found, it is because you have missed its source. Every time you look for much and you can't see it, you have missed the source. God said, ye look for much, and lo, it came to little. And when ye brought it home, I did blow upon it. Why, saith the Lord of hosts. Haggai 1 verse 9. It is because you missed the source. When you miss the source, you miss the price. I would like you to know that every time Israel came under affliction, it was because they missed the source. No source can be truer than God, because he is the truth, he is the life, and he is the way in everything. When God was not given his rightful place, Israel was plagued. These things are written for our examples. You need to be connected to the source of every good and perfect gift. James 1 verse 17. But there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. Romans 10 verse 12. If any Greek can't contact riches, it is not because he is a Greek. It is because he is not connected. So you are not in lack because you are black. You are in want because you are unconnected. You are not down because of the economic situation in the country. You are down because of your word position. It is your word position that determines your position in life. You need an understanding heart. You need an understanding heart to get connected. The Ethiopian eunuch in Acts 8 verse 27 could not get at salvation. He had a knowledge he could read, but he had no understanding. Thus, he could not lay hold on salvation. Salvation was in the passage he was reading. Salvation had taken effect from where he was coming, but his understanding was inadequate to tap into it. The Bible says, good understanding giveth favor, but the way of the transgressor is hard. Proverbs 13 verse 15. That is, the way of those who lack good understanding will be hard. So hardship is a function of ignorance or inadequate understanding. Those who don't have understanding will suffer hardship. It takes understanding, therefore, to escape hardship. Good understanding releases life, but lack of it creates hardship. It's time to be free. You need to ask the Lord for an understanding heart, capable of comprehending every truth that has to do with your inheritance in Christ. The secret of the Lord is with them that fear him, and he will show them his covenant. Psalm 25 verse 14. When you have a heart for God, you are set for a revelation. God reveals things to people who reverence him, not to everybody, but to only those who take him as their only source for an intervention. Before every flood, God prepares an ark. You can't beat God to it. He's always ahead. I believe that before Daniel got into the lion's den, the angel of the Lord was already there waiting. Before the three Hebrew boys arrived in the fiery furnace, the fourth man was already there. There is no way he could have arrived later. They would have been completely burnt. God always prepares an ark of safety before any flood is allowed. Those that fear the Lord will always see his salvation, no matter how terrible the situation. At a time when even a king was crying during an excruciating famine in the land of Israel, the widow of Zarephath had more than enough to eat. If the whole earth burns like an oven, who shall escape? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who can stand if lions invade the city? Daniel, if the flood come upon the earth, who shall escape? Noah and his household. All these people had one thing in common. They feared the Lord. Chapter 5, Operational Guidelines. There are words, guidelines, and instructions that make the law effective. They must be followed. That you want to plant is not what makes you a successful farmer. There are things you must know. You need to be conversant with the regulations that govern the seed you want to plant. For instance, the climate that is most conducive for it, the appropriate fertilizer to apply, the planting season, weeding period, etc. There is no shortcut to abundance. God's intention is to make you cease from struggles, so he gave you a law. Receive, I pray thee, the law from his mouth, and lay up his words in thine heart. If thou return to the Almighty, thou shalt be built up. Job 22, verse 22 to 23. When we are talking about abundance, we are talking about the one you contact from heaven, which brings with it divine protection that makes you enjoy it. God does not bless a man and collect it back through sickness. He does not bless a man and expose him to robbers, nor set his house on fire. No, the blessings of God makes rich and does not add any sorrow. He cuts off anything that curses sorrow. That is why he said, thereby good shall come unto thee. Job 22 verse 21. So anyone who operates this covenant of abundance automatically lives a healthy life. Unlike the blessings of the world, which are temporal, whatsoever the Lord doeth shall be forever. When it is from the Lord, it stays. Whatever you go through the back door to collect will finish when the source finishes. But I am introducing you to a very stable and consistent source that never disappoints. Prove me now. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Malachi 3 verse 10. Everyone who got into this abundance proved him to get there. Abraham proved him him, and God said, Now I know that thou fearest me. In blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Genesis 22 verse 12, 17 to 18. Solomon proved him. He sacrificed 1,000 burnt offerings. Consequently, God unleashed such wealth upon him as no man has ever handled. David also proved him. The Bible tells us that even before David was old and well stricken in age, God had blessed him with honor and riches in every way. 1 Chronicles 29 verse 28. Why did God bless him so? Because he had with his might prepared for the house of his God. They all proved God before they were placed and lifted by him. It is your turn to prove him. Filling up the clouds. Prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. Malachi 3 verse 10. When the windows of heaven open, what you have coming down is rain, which automatically brings about a refreshing not only on your person but on the environment too. But there is really nothing called rain in the atmosphere. What becomes rain by condensation is what evaporates from the face of the earth. What goes up is what comes down. So if no moisture goes up, no rain comes down. If I may say this, it is evaporation before raination. Something must go up before anything pours out. When nothing goes up, nothing is permitted to come down. For the windows of heaven to pour out a blessing to you, the storehouse of heaven must first receive your seed. Until something evaporates from you, nothing evaporates to you. Nothing. So if nothing is going out from you, nothing is permitted to come down to you. That is the law. If I pour out 10 buckets of water on you now, is that equal to the kind of refreshing that rain brings? Only your body is cold, but your environment is still hot. But when rain pours out, both your body and the environment are refreshed. There is nothing that can come from man to you that is equal to refreshing. If it's not coming from above, you remain choked and tensed up, and the heat continues. It will never rain until you allow the evaporation. If the earth refuses the evaporation process, it will remain without rain. If you refuse the law of evaporation, you have nullified the law of refreshing. They go together. May the God of heaven open your understanding and get you out of that cocoon where you have been over the years to the limelight of refreshing. This is the will of God for you. If you cannot serve God with your means, you will end up serving your means. The gold you cannot use to serve God will soon become your God. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Matthew 16 verse 25. Don't live for gold, live for God. The law requires your working it out. Before you can see results, you must work it out yourself. No one can do it for you. Miracles don't just happen. They are worked out by your doing whatsoever he tells you to do, no matter how absurd it may appear. Let me say this with all authority. You don't need to know one person more than this God to get to the topmost top on earth. You don't need to be connected to one man under heaven to get there, because no one can put you higher than where he is. Seek God's connection more than you are seeking human connections. They looked unto him and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed. Psalm 34 verse 5. If you don't want to see shame, look unto God. He is the source. We are coming to a situation now where only those who have direct connection with heaven will be the ones with the answer. This is the key that will free you from all struggles. quality seed for quality harvest. When we were children working on the farm, we used to wonder why our parents would not let us eat the best of the yams, maize, and other crops from the farms. This puzzled us until we grew up and understood that they were merely obeying a rule that would affect future yield. The quality of your seed determines the quality of your harvest. Many children of God in the church today are eating of the precious seeds which are supposed to be preserved for sowing. Long ago, two men brought their offerings before the Lord. One was Cain and the other was Abel. Abel presented the best he had before the Lord. He carefully planned what he would offer to his God and did it with all reverence. Cain, on the other hand, presented whatever came within reach. To him, anything would do. But see what happened. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and his offering he had not respect. Genesis 4 verse 4 to 5. God rates our offerings. The quantity does not move him, but the quality does. Quality seed yields quality harvest. God rates your offering in proportion to what he has blessed you with. Somebody who sows a seed of 10 naira at each service may be worth more in the sight of God than someone who sows 1,000 naira a seed. Remember, David the king said, "Neither will I offer burnt offering unto the Lord my God of that which doth cost me nothing." 2 Samuel 24 verse 24. How dear your seed is to you determines its quality. The Bible says, "Honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of thine increase." Proverbs 3 verse 9. This is what you should do. Your offering should honor God. One of the reasons why God was angry with the Old Testament priests was because they offered contemptible offerings before him. Here is what he told them. "A son honoreth his father, and a servant his master. If then I be a father, where is my honor? And if I be a master, where is my fear? Saith the Lord of hosts unto you, O priests that despise my name. And ye say, wherein have we despised thy name? Ye offer polluted bread upon mine altar. And if ye offer the blind for sacrifice, is it not evil? And if ye offer the lame and sick, is it not evil? Offer it now unto thy governor. Will he be pleased with thee, or accept thy person? Saith the Lord of hosts." Malachi 1 verse 6 to 8. Honor the Lord. This is the key. Give an offering that honors God. So shall thy barn be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. Proverbs 3 verse 10. Giving is work, and it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Deuteronomy 28 verse 1 to 2. Except you do the work of giving, you cannot enjoy the grace for additions. Giving is not for fun. It is work, and it will produce anywhere, anytime, and forever. It is not just doing the work that makes it work. It is doing it with the right attitude. God is not calling for your help. You are the one calling for his help. Your giving is God's strategy for your sustenance and the realization of his destiny for you. If you do it by force, you will not get a thing out of it. Do not not let anybody force you to give, otherwise your giving will be lost. Never give under duress. It will keep you down for life. So willingly, your offering must flow out of a willing heart. You must not be coerced into giving. If you are obedient without being willing, you will not eat the good of the land. The two must necessarily go together for the good of the land to find its way to you. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. Isaiah 1 verse 19. The Lord once commanded Moses, "Take ye from among you an offering unto the Lord. Whosoever is of a willing heart, let him bring it, an offering of the Lord." Exodus 35 verse 5. And verse 29 says, "The children of Israel brought a willing offering unto the Lord, every man and woman whose heart made them willing to bring all manner of work which the Lord had commanded to be made by the hand of Moses." You see, the Lord had commanded it all right, but it had to be a willing offering before it could become acceptable. Apostle Paul gives us the same admonition. "For if I do this thing willingly, I have reward. But if against my will a dispensation of this gospel is committed unto me, what is my reward then?" 1 Corinthians 9 verse 17 to 18. Offering flowing from a willing heart has a reward. Do it cheerfully. Your offerings must be given cheerfully. We have a stern warning from his word, "Because thou servest not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. Therefore thou shalt serve thy enemies which the Lord has sent against thee in hunger and in thirst and in nakedness and in want of all things." Deuteronomy 28 verse 47 to 48. Your lack of cheerfulness in giving can turn your blessings into curses. Locate a good ground. The parable of the sower clearly tells us that not every ground is a good ground. There is the ground by the wayside, open to vandalization by passersby. There is the stony ground, and then the ground of thorns. All these are not profitable for quality harvest. You must locate a good ground, a fertile ground where the seed planted will flourish. Look for a church where the full gospel of God's salvation in every area of life is being preached. There are countless number of these churches around. Locate a good ground. Ask the Lord to direct you. He will lead you to a good ground, a place where the Lord has stamped his name. Only there will your seed yield a harvest. When your blessings come, give God the glory. In Ethan cultures, you see them having great celebration every harvest time. These celebrations are not for fun. They are special days set aside to thank their gods who they claim had given them an abundant harvest. So you see the Igbos in Eastern Nigeria celebrating the New Yam Festival. No one is permitted to eat of the yam harvest until a portion of it has been sacrificed. So also is the Arugungu Fishing Festival in Sokoto, where no one eats of the fish until the best of it is sacrificed. If the Ethan can take time to give honor to dead gods, how much more they who are serving the living God, the Almighty God, who holds the reign of heaven and earth in his hands. Hear what God said. "And now, O ye priests, this commandment is for you, if ye will not hear, and if ye will not lay it to heart, to give glory unto my name, saith the Lord of hosts, I will even send a curse upon you, and I will curse your blessings." Malachi 2 verse 1 to 2. Do you now see how important it is for you to give glory to God for your blessings? The Ethan must have been inspired from the Bible. You must lay it to heart to glorify God each time your harvest comes in. Chapter 6, Covenant Understanding of Money. In this world, money represents power. The Bible says, for wisdom is a defense and money is a defense. Ecclesiastes 7 verse 12. Jesus called money the unrighteous mammon. People who are outside God search for money day and night. Everybody is looking for who to take advantage of and grab something from. Money is the target and life dream of an average natural man. He is after it day and night. But Jesus says, for your heavenly Father knoweth you have need of these things. Matthew 6 verse 32. God is saying, I know you need these things, clothes, shelter, and food, but you do not have to be anxious at all for them. There is a settled plan to get your needs met. A struggle-free plan and strategy that will always work any day, anytime, anywhere. In Matthew 6 verse 24, Jesus said, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. The things that the Gentiles seek for is summed up in mammon. It is the very essence of what the Gentiles are living for. But for you, God has promised in Malachi 3 verse 17, and they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. For everyone that will care to serve God today, the whole world will see the difference tomorrow. God says he is going to distinguish those who serve him. He is saying, if you serve me, money will serve you. If you serve money, mourning will become your companion. When it is God that lifts you, he lifts you to honor you. There is a story of six powerful Americans who held a meeting in 1923. They were six of the most powerful financiers in the world. One of them owned the largest steel company in the world, but none of them had an interesting end. Two of them committed suicide, one became insane, one died penniless, one died a fugitive, and one other became a prisoner. These six men controlled more finances than the whole treasury of the United States of America then. Money without God makes mourners. But when God becomes the supplier of the money in your hands, you will remain the envy of the world around you, because whatever the Lord doeth, it shall be forever. Only the blessings of God maketh rich and added no sorrow to it. The blessings of the devil maketh rich plus plenty of sorrows. This is what Satan does. He lifted Pharaoh and then destroyed him. Everyone he lifted ended up destroyed. Jesus said he only comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. No matter what he pretends to have come to do, whatever he pretends to be doing to help you is only a strategy to hurt you. I have never envied any unbeliever. I do not care what he is or has. There is nothing that life demands that is not in God. All things are made for life and godliness are packaged in redemption. You carry the greatest treasure inside you. Jesus is his name. When you start measuring your life with a sinner's life, it just shows that you need deliverance. By destiny, the world is to envy you. When you begin to envy the world instead, you have lost your identity. You are just like Isaac, a child of promise, who became the envy of the Philistines. Your nation and all the nations of the earth, wherever you step into, will envy your personality from now on in Jesus' name. Your thoughts and attitudes affect what you get from life. You need to change your thoughts and attitudes towards money. If you desire to get maximum yield for your seed sown, change your position and God will change your situation. Here are some truths about money which you need to imbibe in order to change your attitude. It is not the roots of all evil. Many folks say money is the root of all evil and think they are quoting the Bible. Money is not the root of all evil. The Bible does not tell us so. What it says is, for the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. 1 Timothy 6:10. Money is not evil in itself. It is the love of it that leads to so many evil. You'd serve the one you love. If you love money, you will serve money and do anything to acquire it. Money becomes your master. Unknowingly, you begin to worship it. It becomes the deciding factor in any step you want to take in life. When money becomes your greatest consideration in every affair in life, then know that you are very far from God. Jesus said you cannot serve God and mammon, money. But if you serve God faithfully, you will have money, which God created for use. He created the silver, gold, and every precious stone, and the Bible tells us they were very good. Don't deny your need for money. The subject of money is an all-important subject, except to hypocrites in Zion. You can't do without money daily. The word of God says, money answereth all things. Ecclesiastes 10:19. There is nothing that can get successfully done on this earth without money. All transactions on earth are programmed around money. Everything you need in life answers to money. Food, clothes, shelter, everything that makes for a living. Jesus said, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. John 10:10. Everything on earth plus eternal life is what makes up abundant life. Stop pretending that you do not need money. Admit your need for it and you will have it, because God only supplies your need. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:19. The need for money is in good measure cannot be overemphasized. You do not only need to have it, you need to have it in abundance. It is the abundance of it that is relevant to your welfare and that of others. Don't let hypocrisy rob you of your heritage. Money is a defense. The Bible tells us that money is a defense. Ecclesiastes 7:12. It keeps one from the harassments of life. No matter how spiritual you are, you can't stay in a house without paying the rent. Money is a defense. A poor man in any society is not treated the same way as a rich man. Without money, you are socially defenseless. There are countless multitudes languishing in various prisons today who have not been told the offense they committed. It is only people without means who fall victims of such treatment. Money gives you a voice. Let us get this small illustration from God's word. There was a little city and few men within it, and there came a great king against it and besieged it and built great bulwarks against it. Now there was found in it a poor wise man, and he by his wisdom delivered the city. Yet no man remembered that same poor man. Then said I, wisdom is better than strength. Nevertheless, the poor man's wisdom is despised, and his words are not heard. Ecclesiastes 9:14-16. It is wise for the wise man to have money. Money gives a voice to the wisdom he possesses. Now hear this. Without money, the gospel cannot be spread all over the world. Money will give voice to the gospel. It is the wheel upon which this end time wisdom of God will ride. When a preacher approaches an unbeliever to share the good news, the first thing that the sinner does is to size him up. If the preacher looks poor, then he doesn't show him any form of respect and most often will treat his words with disdain. But when the preacher looks better than he does. The unbeliever gets more interested because he knows the preacher does not want his money. Money gives a voice to wisdom. There is only one way to get money. There is only one way to get money. This is by giving away what you have. For you to have money, you must make giving your way of life. Give to God and give to brethren in need. This is the only way you can have money. Holding tight to what you have leads to poverty and lack. There is that scattereth and yet increaseth, and there is that withholdeth more than is meet, but it tendereth to poverty. Proverbs 11 verse 24. When you give money, you are not helping God. When you give to the work of God, you are not helping God. This is an attitude which has robbed many believers of their inheritance in God. God does not depend on you for food. The cattle on the 1,000 hills are his. See Psalm 50. He cannot depend on you for food. The silver and the gold are all his also. Haggai 2 verse 8. In fact, Psalm 24 verse 1 tells us, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. God does not depend on you to sustain his kingdom. He can do it all by himself. The reason he allows you to be involved is because he wants to bless you. God does not need your money. Giving is a channel which God has opened for man to receive his blessings. When you give, you are only building your destiny, for you are too small to help God. Poverty is not a sign of righteousness. Poverty is not a sign of righteousness. The Bible says that Jesus is the righteousness of God. Jesus, the righteousness of God, came down to earth in the form of human flesh. By the records we have of his ministry, he was not poor. He had so much that he needed a treasurer to keep his money. He ate whatever he wanted and whenever he desired it. He lived in a place that commanded envy, because John's disciples, who went to see where he lived, never returned to their master. They remained with Jesus. Now, Jesus was not only righteous, he was the expression of the righteousness that God demands from us. So, if you walk in poverty, you don't look like Jesus. We are representations of Jesus. So we should be an expression of Jesus to the world, the same way Jesus was to the Father. Lack of any kind is a curse. A good look at the curses of the law listed in Deuteronomy 28 shows that the most prominent among them is the curse of poverty. Lack is embedded in almost every curse enumerated. The curse of the law is a reverse of man's wealth. Poverty is a curse, not an influence of the economic situation of the world. The day you start to see it that way, you will be free from it. One of the reasons why Jesus came was to bring man into a covenant link with God. God called a man named Abraham and used him to prove his purpose for man by releasing blessings upon him and his generations to come. The Bible tells us why Jesus was crucified. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Galatians 3 verse 13 to 14. Jesus, by his death on the cross, rendered the curse of the law that was upon us null and void, and brought us into the Abrahamic covenant of blessings. Chapter 7, The Little Foxes. A man of God once said, our attitude determines our altitude. I have seen men who are dedicated Christians, but who seem to be going around on the same spot. I have wondered and asked the Lord what could be responsible for this. He opened my eyes to a few things, which I am going to share in this chapter. We are going to discuss the little things which go unnoticed notice, but which are very vital to your growth, especially in the area of abundance. These are the little foxes mentioned in Songs of Solomon. Take us the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. Songs of Solomon 2 verse 15. Compromising your integrity. The things that trouble men are in hidden places. The diseases that afflict men are inside of them. It is only the effect you see on the outside. The same thing occurs in the world of the spirit. The things that make men stranded, taunted, and unable to move forward are all in hidden places. It takes the x-ray of God's light to expose them. The world lives for money. It is their God. They run after it. They seek after it without any reservation. A natural man's thirst for money is insatiable. He wants more and more of it. They are like the grave which is never satisfied. Never let money become your idol. Don't let it become the most important thing in your life. If it does, then it has become your God. Money should be an instrument of worshiping God. It should never be allowed to become your master. It must be kept as your servant. The moment money begins to direct all your affairs, you are doomed. Jesus Christ said, "Ye cannot serve God and mammon." Matthew 6 verse 24. This implies that there is a tendency for men to worship money instead of God. Money is the greatest contestant for the place of God in a man's life. Many have cast their vote for it and have been snared away from the truth. Beware. God wants you to prosper. He wants to bless you financially, but he does not want you to pursue after money the way the sinners do. He wants you to pursue after the things of God. This is the only way the true riches of God will come to you, he said. Therefore, take no thought saying, "What shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Matthew 6 verse 31-33. The only acceptable foundation for abundant living, according to the word of God, is the pursuit of God and the things that please him. Find out what pleases God and seek to please him in all your dealings. This is your foundation for supernatural additions in life. God has reserved an Eden of abundance for you. It is your inheritance in life. Integrity will take you there. Integrity will keep you there. Outside of integrity, you don't have a financial future in the kingdom. This truth is unfolded all over scriptures. The integrity of the upright shall guide them, but the perverseness of transgressors shall destroy them. Proverbs 11 verse 3. The just man walketh in his integrity. His children are blessed after him. Proverbs 20 verse 7. Integrity is a seed from which your children's children can draw. Righteousness does not dry people up. It establishes them and causes them to flourish. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing to show that the Lord is upright. He is my rock and there is no unrighteousness in him. Psalm 92 verse 12-15. Right dealings doesn't reduce man's height. They promote and sustain it. Jesus Christ said in Luke 16 verse 10-11. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore ye have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? riches. The way you handle your financial dealings determines greatly what happens to you financially. Many things that afflict men are traceable to their monetary dealings. False financial dealings can open doors to inexplicable afflictions. Why must you buy your goods at $3 and say you bought them at $10 each just because you want profit? You are free to sell your goods at whatever price you desire, but you don't have to tell lies to do so. Even in the church today, you have to cross-check almost everything that is being purchased because you are not sure of the integrity of those involved. God is calling his people to order. He is saying that if you are not truthful in your financial dealings with your neighbor, you are corrupting your future and exposing yourself to unnecessary afflictions. If you are in a business that will not allow you to be straight, leave it and start another one. Unrighteousness will keep a man on the same spot for life. You cannot get people saved when you engage in what they do. Something happened some time ago that involved this ministry. A Christian brother from our church in Kaduna went to Lagos to buy some things. On his way back at the Lagos airport, he discovered that he had underpaid for the goods he bought to the tune of 10,000 naira. The calculation on the receipt was wrong. He left the airport and went back to the office. He explained what had happened. The chairman of the company could not believe it. "Are there still Nigerians like this around?" he asked. The brother explained that he was a Christian and couldn't take what didn't belong to him. The chairman wrote me a personal letter thanking me for bringing up men like that. It was in that man's power to take the money, but he chose to please God. His testimony affected lives for Jesus. Cases abound all over scriptures of men and women who missed their destiny in God by running after unrighteous gains. Gehazi was a man who, by virtue of his position, could have stepped into the shoes of Elisha. Elisha served Elijah faithfully and received a double portion of his power through his mantle. Now here was Gehazi, Elisha's servant, who purchased leprosy for himself and his generations to come. Why? He ran greedily after unrighteous gain by collecting from Naaman the Syrian the money which Elisha, his master, had already rejected. Look at Balaam. God told him, "Do not go." But the lure of the money offered to him to curse God's people was too strong. He went and he perished. What about Achan? He was the champion of the accursed things. He stole and hid what God had clearly instructed against. He wanted to get rich very quickly, but he died very quickly, along with his household. Ananias and Sapphira had a good project in mind. They sold their land for the sake of the gospel, but they agreed to withhold a part of the money. When confronted, they told a lie. They died the same day. Unrighteousness is a destiny destroyer. Don't walk in the way these people have walked. We are in a very tempting period in world history, but you don't have to be crooked to make it. It is the blessings of the Lord that will make you rich, not your smartness or crookedness. God is out to bless his church, but he will not do it through perverseness. Covetousness. Beware of covetousness. Life does not consist in the abundance of the things you have, but in your possessions with God. God is the source of every good and perfect gift. If you have God, then good things should not be a problem to you. Don't envy sinners. Their riches are but for a moment. They never last. Don't let material things blind you to your privileged position in God. Discontentment. Be contented with the placement of God in your life. The way it is now is not your end. The best is yet to come. Integrity will procure it for you. Those who live for money shall fall into temptations, snares, and foolish, hungry lusts, which which draw men into destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. 1 Timothy 6:11. God is saying, don't live for money, live for me, and you will enjoy all that I have, money inclusive. This is the secret of financial buoyance and social peace. Chapter 8, some missing links. There are things that enhance one's rate of results. In this flamboyant age where everybody is seeking for position and fame, these things have been forgotten and the struggles have ever continued. You can't break scriptures. Anything that attempts to break the unbreakable shall be broken. God abides faithful. He cannot deny himself. If anything is wrong along the line, it must be with man. It's therefore important for us to keep checking. The land is flowing with milk and honey, but it's only for those who are willing and obedient, not for rascals who want to do things their own way. This end time is a covenant time. Covenant people are going to be right at the top because God will be dealing with his people on the basis of the covenant. So understand the mystery. It's not the people you know. It's not the people that know you, nor the government that is in power. It is your attitude that must change. Something is happening. You must not be a victim of this hour of gross darkness upon the earth, but a testimony. People are selling themselves while others are buying possessions. Some are growing while others are dying. Some are multiplying while others are finishing. The only security the godly has now is to become more and more godly. If the covenant is what distinguishes people, then we must face the covenant very squarely. Your destiny has its roots in the quality of your covenant walk with God. You must face it very squarely. John Avanzini said, walking with God is not a simple process. It is a complex one. Various factors come together to make the whole. So we must be sensitive to identify which one is missing per time so we can increase our rate of fruitfulness. Honor thy father and thy mother. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. Ephesians 6:1-2. There are too many people today who are paying tithes and giving offering, but who it is not well with because the major covenant is out of place. They eat everything they get without remembering that they have a father and mother. It is your job to honor your father and mother. You can't change your father. It is too late. Also, you can't change your mother. When you stop honoring them, God says, I will dishonor you. You cannot be eating turkey, beef, chicken, fish, and all kinds of delicious meals while your parents are out there virtually starving. God said it will not be well with you. You say, but I give my tithe. Yes, but the scriptures cannot be broken. It is the scripture you are breaking that is breaking you. There must be a change. We must respond to the demands of the covenant. Remember, the same Ephesians 6:3 says that it may be well with thee and thou mayest live long on the earth. This is an assurance, a guarantee that accidents can't claim your life, nor can witches and wizards, because you are on a covenant wavelength with God. Proverbs 20:2. 20 says, whoso curseth his father or his mother, his lamb shall be put out in obscure darkness. I know many of our parents must have done certain wrong things in the past. Forget that and do what God tells you to do. Even if your parents have done you any hurt, that does not give you a license to dishonor them. Many of you, your parents have never seen your one naira. No wonder you are struggling and sweating. If things are not well with you, that might as well be the reason you are eating so well and enjoying yourself, while your parents are back there suffering hunger and deprivation. Watch it. It may be well for a season, but not for all seasons. There is something in parental blessing. You better go and look for it. Family relationships. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. 1 Peter 3 verse 7. Deal with your wife according to knowledge. Otherwise, your heaven will be closed and your connection with God will be disconnected. If you have a leaking store, do you keep things in it? If your family life is leaking, it's not conducive for harvest. Disallow any leakage in your home, or the heavens will withhold their rain. Deal with them according to knowledge. What is this knowledge? Ephesians 5 verse 25 says, husbands, love your wife, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. That is the knowledge that will check leakage in your family and help you experience harvest. You must not open up your home to malice. You must not allow discord to enter into your home. You must not give the devil a place, or your access will be blocked, giving honor unto the wife. That's against the African mentality. Let me ask you, if a car has an accident, who do you interview? The passenger or the driver? Who should be blamed? When the Eden car had an accident, who did God go looking for? Genesis 3 verse 9 says, and the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? I don't care what your theology is. If there's any problem in your home, you, the man, are the number one suspect. That's the truth. Your knowledge of the family life is inadequate. That's what has led to an eruption in your home. You can avoid problems. You can subdue them. You can overcome them. You can prevail over them. I see God giving you wisdom. Family responsibilities. Paul the apostle came by a very strong revelation in 1 Timothy 5 verse 8. But if any provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he has denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. The responsibility of providing for the home is the man's job. Otherwise, he will live a life worse than the sinner's life. When the earth is burning like an oven, he will also be burnt. No matter the volumes of tithes and offerings he gives, the Bible says he has denied the faith. That is, he will suffer what unbelievers suffer. When you embrace the word of God, your destiny is established. To provide for your family is your duty as a man. It is your job. It must be joyfully accepted and excitedly executed. You will not disappoint God. You must be concerned about your wife and children's welfare. You must see it as your responsibility and must embrace it as such. You must be concerned about the clothes your wife wears. It's your job, so you won't be disconnected from eternal life. I see a new change coming. I see people accepting covenant responsibilities and flying to untold heights by them. I see you looking at your children with excitement, not seeing them as burdens. I see you pay their school fees without frowning your face. I see you buying them clothes with excitement. Let go and let God. Therefore, therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king, which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him, which owed him 10,000 talents. But forasmuch as he had not to pay, his lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife, and his children, and all that he had, and payment to be made. The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. Then the lord of that servant was moved with compassion, and loosed him, and forgave him the debt. But the same servant went out, and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence. And he laid hands on him, and took him by the throat, saying, Pay me that thou owest. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet, and besought him, saying, Have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison, till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry, and came and told unto their lord all that was done. Then his lord, after that he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt, because thou desirest me. Shouldest not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his lord was wroth, and delivered him to the tormentors, till he should pay all that was due unto him. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if ye from your hearts forgive not every one his brother their trespasses. Matthew 18:23-35. If anybody is owing you, and you know he is not in a position to pay, just say, I forgive you. God has more for you than what any man is owing you. Forgive the person, then watch to see whether God is more than that or not. Don't bind your brother or sister because he or she is owing you. Don't make them live under tension. Perfect love casts out fear. Fear has torment. Don't torment your business anymore. Now tell me, if that money was taken by your son and he is not able to pay you, would you disown him? Jesus said, So shall the Lord do to every one of you, if you will not from your heart forgive your brother. Where the person is not in a position to pay you, don't become possessed with the situation. Every form of hatred has torments. Today that brother or sister needs help, but tomorrow he can become a source of help even to you. God is faithful. You can let go today. Pay your workers well, for the laborer is worthy of his hire. Luke 10:7. If you are in a business where you hire laborers and people work for you, and yet you are living in splendor without considering them, then you are a fraud. Your business will not flourish. That is the word of God, and the scriptures cannot be broken. To put a secretary on seat to work from morning till late at night, and all you pay her is 1,200 naira at the end of the month, is wickedness. You don't need a secretary. Carry a pen and paper, and write down whatever you want by yourself. I am glad to tell you, God pays his people. He is a rewarder of those who diligently serve him. You are not in a position to pay your workers. Let them know and give them a chance to choose to go or to stay. May you allow people under you to grow. Pay your workmen or do your work yourself. You go to Sheraton Hotel to squander money, feasting friends and so-called business associates, and you pay your workmen 1,000 naira a month, you are a wicked fellow. Mind you, a houseboy today is not going to be a houseboy tomorrow or forever. So don't look at him as a slave. Remember Joseph. Remember your Father in heaven is a loving Father. You will eat all the fruits of your labor. From today, you shall be reckoned reckoned with by all around you as very great. These are all hidden covenant mysteries that make one seed to bring forth an hundredfold, now in this time and in the world to come. Thank God for all that you have given in the kingdom. Thank God for all your tithe and offerings. But these are other covenant responsibilities that make one seed produce. There will be no more leakage in your home and family. No more leakage in your finances too. Let's invite the harvest. Talk big, talk wealth. Talking about the wisdom of God in Job 28 verse 9 to 10, the Bible says, He putteth forth his hand upon the rock. He overturned the mountains by the roots. He curteth out rivers among the rocks, and his eye seeth every precious thing. Rivers here represent God's pleasures, that is, supplies and provisions. God is able to make us enjoy pleasures in the midst of hardship. This is what is meant by He curteth out rivers among the rocks. In spite of economic troubles, we can still enjoy divine supplies. He overturned the mountains by the roots. That is, He humiliates opposition, barriers, and obstacles. How? For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, Be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Mark 11 verse 23. Jesus came to show us the path of wisdom. When you know the path that others don't know, you will definitely get the results that none of them get. When you have discovered what no natural man has access to, then you must experience and encounter what no man naturally has ever experienced. Nothing comes to light until it is declared. Genesis 1 is full of this wisdom of God. The earth was without form and void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. There was utter confusion everywhere. Then wisdom stepped unto action. And God said, Let there be light, and there was light. Genesis 1 verse 3. And God said, Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. Genesis 1 verse 6. And God said, Let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so. Genesis 1 verse 9. And God said, Let the earth bring forth grass, the herbs yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth, and it was so. Genesis 1 verse 11. And God said, Let there be light in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. Genesis 1 verse 14. And God said, Let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that has life, and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven. Genesis 1 verse 20. And God said, Let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping things, and beasts of the earth after his kind. And it was so. Genesis 1 verse 24. And God said, Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Genesis 1 verse 26. Then in Genesis 1:31, and God saw everything that he had made with his mouth, and behold, it was very good. Everything that happened at creation responded to what God said. Now hear me, no matter the state of your finances, the mystery behind creation will restore order and dignity. You have seen the strategy God employed to be wiser than God is to be a big fool. What you will never say, you will never live to see. The only wise God needed declaration before he had manifestation. And God said, not fight, cry, wish, or just believe. If you want the mountain of financial hardship overturned by the root, you must engage in the kind of strategy God used. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Romans 10 verse 10. You cannot experience the benefits of what you believe until you say it. For it to work for you, you must declare it. You will never see wealth until you start talking it. You will never enjoy abundance until you declare it with absolute confidence. Many were angry at my declarations in the early days of this ministry. It was strange to them to hear me say, I cannot be poor. This was because as of that time, from all natural and physical indications, poverty was my next door neighbor. But I kept to my declarations. I cannot be poor. Now it is undoubtedly evident. When the man of God, Kenneth Copeland, first started preaching his prosperity message, he was a laughingstock, as he was not in any way a representation of his message. However, it was in his heart, and if he truly believed it, it was mandatory that he declared it. Today, he is an enviable figure in the world. Presently, he has given out 3 jets at Eagle Mountain, where his office is. He has an airstrip where his jets land every morning, and he just walks down to his office. He is not in any other business other than the covenant business. In Proverbs 12 verse 14, the Bible says, a man shall be satisfied with good by the fruit of his mouth. What you do with your hands will always be rewarded by what you say with your mouth. The leadership of your country is not why you are breaking down. If you talk the way they talk, you will suffer the way they suffer. Consecrate your lips for covenant use, for the time has come for you to enjoy plenty. Friends, there is no place your mouth cannot talk you to. When you talk mediocrity, it will become your garment. When you talk lack, you will have it until you become lack yourself. You can't be too gentle and become a conqueror. It takes manliness to subdue opposition. If you want to have a living financial experience, speak life to your finances. Water your seeds. Many of us are suffering under covenant drought, while many others have destroyed their seeds in the earth, all because they don't know what it means to water those seeds. I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. 1 Corinthians 3 verse 6. You give tithes, offerings, and invest into the lives of the poor. So why should you still remain poor? No matter your obedience to the law, you need to always know the word that makes the law produce. Job 22 verse 21 to 28 says, acquaint now thyself with him, and be at peace, thereby good shall come unto thee. Receive, I pray thee, the law from his mouth, and lay off his words in thine heart. Thou shalt also decree a thing, and it shall be established unto thee. What you will not decree will not be established. If you are not a talker of abundance, no matter how much you obey the law, you will live in scarcity. Your mouth is the instrument that gives God's wisdom expression through you. Luke 21 verse 15 says, for I will give you a mouth and a wisdom which all your adversaries shall not be able to gainsay or resist. There's always a planting and a watering before God brings the increase. Your seed can never become fruit without water. God's word is that water. Since we are created in his image, the words we speak therefore are also water. If you put a mirror right before your face and speak. No matter how civilized you are, you will see water in form of mist form on the mirror. Do you want the mountain of poverty overturned by the roots in your life? Then speak to it. It is time to open your mouth wide and comply with covenant demands. Every time you say, "There is no rice," rice finishes. Nothing finishes until you finish it with your mouth. Many have destroyed their financial destinies and welfare in Christ through the careless use of their mouth. Every time a covenant child contravenes the details of the covenant, he loses like a natural man would. Let us follow God's approach and experience his blessings. Let's go outside the gates bearing the reproach and declaring our possessions in God. If you are not in doubt, why don't you talk about your returns with confidence? If you believe that when you give sacrificially, God turns your captivity, declare it so that God can perform it. Don't lose your heavenly identity. Don't join the heathen to talk woes and failures. Let the weak say, "I am strong." Joel 3 verse 10 and Isaiah 8 verse 12 to 14 says, "Say ye not a confederacy to all them to whom this people shall say a confederacy. Neither fear ye their fear, nor be afraid. Sanctify the Lord of hosts himself, and let him be your fear, and let him be your dread. And he shall be for a sanctuary, but for a stone of stumbling, and for a rock of offense to both the house of Israel. Consecrate your lips for covenant use." Friends, wisdom has bailed you out. Right now, begin to speak. Declare, "Poverty has nothing to do with me anymore. I am a covenant child. Abundance is my heritage, plenty my lot. I can never be under oppression anymore. I am above because I obey God. I have his word and I comply with it. Therefore, I am not below. I am on top." From now on, when somebody asks you, "How are you going?" declare, "Fantastic, great. Your best days are here now." Join me in looking for more techniques to make your life a living proof of the reality and practicality of the gospel. As children of God, you are supposed to enjoy fruitfulness and abundance in the land of affliction. It must show diligence. There is no affluence without impute. The Bible says in Proverbs 13 verse 11, "Wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished, but he that gathereth by labor shall increase." At creation, we saw God as a worker. Jesus came and we saw him as a worker. Abraham at 75 years was a worker too. Isaac and Jacob also came and we saw them as workers. Now, who are you going to resemble going about idle? Idleness is a self-inflicted curse. We just must know the secret behind increase. Greatness never comes by accident. In Proverbs 22 verse 29, the Bible says, "Seest thou a man diligent in his business, he shall not stand before mean men." There is dignity in labor. Jesus said, "I must work." And Paul the apostle in 1 Corinthians 15 verse 10 said, "But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me." There is no future for the idle in the kingdom. 2 Thessalonians 3 verse 10 says, "If any would not work, neither should he eat." The prosperous church is a doing church. The prosperous Christian is a doing Christian. "And whatsoever he doeth shall prosper." Psalm 1 verse 3. Many of us carry ideas bigger than our size about. Proverbs 13 verse 23 says, "Much food is in the tillage of the poor. If the poor man will choose to cultivate and till the ground, he will discover much food where he has been suffering hunger." Jesus said, "My Father walketh hitherto and I work." John 5 verse 17. Your Father is working, your Master is working, and you are sleeping. How will you escape? A wise man once said, there will never be another you, so make the most of your life. There will never be another time, so make the best of it today. Many of us have sown a lot of seeds, but have not created avenues for returns because our hands have not become working hands. In all labor, there is profit. Labor is the word. It is time to start working. If your father is working and your master is working, it only makes sense for you to be a worker. A wise man once said that people who think they are too big to do little things are perhaps too little to be asked to do big things. Small opportunities are often the beginning of great enterprises. I say smallness is the sure foundation for greatness. The longest journey is made step by step. You have a great future, but the scriptures cannot be broken. You can't continue in laziness and idleness and expect greatness. If it comes by any mistake, it is a trap. Remember, wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished. Proverbs 13 verse 11. Labor is the pathway to increase. Dr. Fred Price said, we have not succeeded by accident. If wishes were horses, all beggars will ride. Stop wishing and waiting. Great is your future. Increase comes by covenant labor. We must ensure that our children are no longer idle. Show them by examples that there is dignity in labor. When you work, God is committed to make you fat and also fatten your work, finances, and health. When the Lord called me into ministry, I told a friend, you know the reason I'm going full-time? It is so I can go full length. I told him that I am determined that nobody doing ministry part-time will match me in the race. It is impossible. You can't be tired of hearing me because I am not tired of working. I study, I meditate, and I document. I also write. I know my job. I am doing my job, so I must be paid by the one who employed me. I do not have any other interest in town. My job is the only reason I am here. I am a laborer. I am a gospeler. I am staying with my job. Stay on your job or you will lose color. You have only one shop and you are never there. What kind of a trader are you? You say my clerk is very bad. It's because you are also very bad. There is no staff with me today who comes late to work and is comfortable around me for the whole day. Thank God for grace, but thank God much more that we are able to use the grace for labor. May the Lord give you understanding. There is dignity in labor. Stop eating your uncle's free food. The word of God says, say ye to the righteous that it shall be well with him, for they shall eat the fruit of their doings. Isaiah 3 verse 10. It is time to do something. You can do something. Today, I work 18 hours on the average per day, yet it doesn't show on my body. No idle man can survive around me. Nobody can work with me and enjoy life without working. There is something we call labor baptism in our ministry. When you come in, you lose weight. You have wished enough. Now go and work. If you are a granite seller, be the granite seller. If you are a laborer on the field, be the laborer. Joseph prospered as a houseboy. He prospered as a prisoner. He was an excited worker. You are a covenant child. You must prosper. Jacob was a stranger in the house of Laban, and he was very prosperous. He became the envy of Laban. It is time to work. If you are a giver, much more so must you be a worker. There is enough in the covenant to make things work for you. Even in famine, you can make it. In Genesis 26, the Bible records that there was famine in the land. For others, it was a time to complain. But for Isaac, it was a time to work like never before. Consequently, he went forward and became very great, and the Philistines envied him. The Bible says, go to the ant, thou sluggard, consider her ways and be wise. Proverbs 6 verse 6. They don't have have a guide or a leader, yet they make their houses and prepare their food. You don't need supervision to work. You just need covenant intelligence. All you need do is to work, and God's business is to prosper you. There is a future in what you are doing. You don't need to run away to any other country. There is nothing anywhere else that cannot be found where you are now. You are not created to be a beggar. Give it all you have got. Black has nothing to do with the color of your skin. Slothfulness and lack of commitment to your job, business, and responsibilities are what make you black. Look not upon me because I am black, because the sun has looked upon me. My mother's children were angry with me. They made me the keeper of the vineyard, but my own vineyard have I not kept. Songs of Solomon 1 verse 6. God has delivered you. Don't put yourself back in chains. There is enough to do in your own country that will bring you lifting. May you find it. Never mind the retirement age of the government. At 75, Abraham was still a worker. At 92, he led an army out to war. He was a cattle rearer and became very rich in silver and gold. Listen to me. If they retire you at 50, it is for a new chapter to open in your life. If you go to sit down at 50, you will decay before you are 60. If Abraham was strong at 100, by the time you are 100, you will have the strength of a 40-year-old. Caleb said, 40 years ago, I came out here, and 45 years later, my strength is still intact. That shall be your testimony. Put in your best where you are working. Even though they don't know it now, they will know it later. The covenant will locate you. Your lifting will be effective and your future secure. Give it all you have got. Solomon said, whatever thy hand findeth to do, do it with all thy might. Ecclesiastes 9 verse 10. Be known with your job. No more trial and error. There is enough time to be the best God has created you to be. Have joy in the work you are doing. Be excited about the labor of your hands. There is a future in it. Never be idle for one whole hour. The church is getting back to her position this end time. We are taking our position back as a pace-setting community. It shall be so in your own private life. In your business, they will know you very shortly as the one in charge. In your career too. From now on, your hand will be strong in labor. Chapter 9. Behold the windows of heaven. You can maintain the flow of God's blessings and remain permanently established in wealth. Abraham's example. The man Abraham was a man greatly blessed by God. He was called in Genesis 12 verse 1 to 3, and in chapter 13 too, we were told, and Abraham was very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. Abraham had obeyed God in the parting from his old ways. His obedience was greatly rewarded by God, but Abraham did not become permanently entrenched in his blessing until he took another step, which must have been revealed to him by God. In Genesis 14, we see Abraham being established in God's plan and purpose. He went out to battle against the kings who had taken his brother's son Lot captive. He defeated the kings and returned with a great spoil. As he was returning from the battlefront, Abraham met Melchizedek, the king of Salem, the priest of the Most High God. We are told in Hebrews that this Melchizedek was Jesus, our high priest. It was one of the Old Testament appearances of Jesus. Jesus appeared as a priest to Abraham, and we are told that Abraham gave him a title tenth of all the spoil. Melchizedek blessed Abraham, saying, blessed be Abraham of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. Genesis 14 verse 19. Remember, the Lord had only promised to bless Abraham when he was called in Genesis 12. But now the Lord pronounced Abraham blessed when he paid the tithe. Thus, Abraham was permanently established in his blessing through the tithe. It was only when Abraham had paid tithe that the other aspects of his blessings began to appear. What is tithing? Tithing is a systematic release of a tenth of all your increase to God. The tithe means one tenth or 10%. God has made it clear that tithing is not given. It is a special portion of your increase, which God has reserved for himself. He tells us in Leviticus 27 verse 30, and all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy unto the Lord. This portion does not belong to you. It belongs to God and must be given personally to him as soon as your increase comes in. It is not yours to give. Therefore, it does not constitute a part of your giving. The practice of tithing had existed before the law was given to Moses. Jacob practiced it. God had told Jacob that he would be blessed, but Jacob did not get established in that blessing until he made a vow at Bethel to pay his tithe. And he called the name of that place Bethel. And Jacob vowed a vow, saying, if God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God. And this stone which I have set for a pillar shall be God's house. And of all that thou shalt give me, I will surely give the tenth unto thee. Genesis 28 verse 19 to 22. I am sure Jacob, in his characteristic usurping way, had been withholding his tithe. When he made a vow to be serious, God took him and planted him in his blessings. To further emphasize the importance of tithing, let us look at what God told Jacob when he instructed him to go back to his father's house. God said, I am the God of Bethel, where thou anointed the pillar, and where thou vowest a vow unto me. Now arise, get thee out from this land, and return unto the land of thy kindred. Genesis 31 verse 13. God did not tell Jacob, I am the God of your fathers. Rather, he told him, I am the God of Bethel. This shows the importance God attached to the vow of tithing which Jacob had made. This practice has not changed. The coming of Jesus has not abolished it. He is our great high priest, and he is still receiving our tithe, even as he received Abraham thousands of years ago. Jesus said, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matter of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought ye to have done, and not to leave the other undone. Matthew 23 verse 23. He thus put a stamp on tithing as a New Testament practice. God has not changed. He uses the tithe as a means of establishing individuals in their blessings. He is still doing it today. This is the key to financial stability. Tithing is divine insurance. A woman in one of our chapels had a mysterious experience. She was used to paying her tithe. A day came when she decided not to pay. Consequently, mysterious rats invaded the bonnet of her car and ate up all the wires. She got the car fixed, but the rats appeared again and ate up all the new wires. This continued until her eyes were opened. She rushed to the office to pay her tithes, and the rats mysteriously disappeared. Those were no ordinary rats. Those rats were devourers. They were sent on a mission from heaven's devourer agency. God has promised the tithe, and I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruit of your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field. Malachi 3 verse 11. The devourer can come in various forms. Frequent car breakdowns, losses, sicknesses, and so on are all manifestations of the devourer. You can put an end to the devourer's harassment by paying your tithe regularly. Tithing is your insurance cover against destruction and disruption of all forms. Tithers and givers in the kingdom of God have literally been waiting for treasures to drop down from heaven. They have been waiting for houses, land, cars, money, and so on to drop down on their heads from heaven. They are ignorant of the forces that are released when they give. It is important to know what happens when you pay your tithe and give your offerings. The windows of heaven. The first time this word appeared in the Bible was in the days of Noah. The Bible recalls in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the same day where all the fountains of the great deep broken up and the windows of heaven were opened. Genesis 7 verse 11. Remember also that God swore after the flood never to destroy the earth in that way anymore. And I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood. Neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. Genesis 9 verse 11. In Malachi 3 verse 10, God promised the tither this: bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. What does this promise from God represent? Now listen. Cars are not going to drop down from heaven. Food, shelter, and clothing will not come tumbling down from the sky either. But God has said we will be blessed with great abundance. How is he going to do this? The rain of ideas. Rain is released through the windows of heaven every time your tithe and offerings are sent there and they are accepted by God. But this is not literal rain. It is not a destructive rain. It is the rain God spoke about in Zechariah. Ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain. So the Lord shall make bright clouds and give them showers of rain to everyone grass in the field. Zechariah 10 verse 1. This is a rain of refreshing. It is the rain of the Spirit of God, the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It is the rain that produces unimaginable abundance in Joel chapter 2. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. And the floors shall be full of wheat, and the vats shall overflow with wine and oil. And I will restore to you the years that the locust has eaten, the canker worm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you, and ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God that has dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. Joel 2 verse 23 to 26. This is the rain that God is going to release through the windows of of heaven. How? Talking about Jesus, the word of God says he will operate in the spirit of the Lord. The major attributes of the spirit are outlined. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his root, and the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. Isaiah 11 verse 1 to 2. This analysis of the spirit of the Lord simply stands for wisdom and power. The spirit of knowledge, counsel, understanding, and the fear of the Lord are all elements of wisdom. This spirit of the Lord that was upon Jesus was essentially the spirit of wisdom and power. This is why 1 Corinthians 1 verse 24 clearly states Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. By opening the windows of heaven, God pours out his wisdom and power upon the giver. What is wisdom? What is power? Wisdom is simply the ability of God and a man, which enables him to know what to do at every point in time. A friend of mine described wisdom as the knowledge of what next to do. Power is defined as the ability to do work. What your giving releases from heaven, therefore, is a rain of ideas
and the power
to carry out those ideas. This is what makes for riches. Prosperity is rooted in what to do, and you are not told what to do unless you are a giver. Giving releases divine direction and the ability to pursue that direction. Chapter 10, Captivity Turning Testimonies. God lifted me from nothing. God lifted me from nothing to over 1.8 million naira. In 1993, my kingdom investment was a little over 10,000 naira. But I made a vow with God in November 1993 that since he lifted me, I will serve him with all my might. In January 1994, my kingdom investment was a minimum of 20,000 naira. By May, the Holy Spirit spoke to me saying, "My son, you are bigger than what you are given now." So I increased it to 35,000 naira. By September, the Holy Spirit spoke to me again and I went up to 95,000 naira. Towards December, God expanded my business. He provided a computer which I use in making all my designs and customers' data collation. At the end of January this year, I asked my accountant to find out what we made for the year and our kingdom investment. He told me that the turnover was over 4.3 million naira and kingdom investment was over 515,000 naira. My debtors paid me. On December 31st / January 1st, I was able to give 50 naira as my Thanksgiving offering. I then decided to be giving 100 naira as offering for any service. But by the third week in January, I traveled out of Lagos on a Friday. I was unable to go to the bank. This left me cashless on Sunday. The Spirit then ministered to me to give my offering in check. Before then, the bishop had said that any payment in check must not be less than 500 naira. So I wrote out a check for 500 naira. For the family fellowship on Tuesday, I did the same thing. Since then, I decided to always give my offerings in check. As a result of this, three of my debtors have paid me back what they owed me. The first was 30,000 naira cash I loaned somebody. The other was 48,000 naira being payment for a job done, and the third was payment for a consultancy job I had done since November. Somebody sat on the check, but through the grace of God, I was paid. I got a check of 313,000 naira and $4,900 because it was a World Bank project. I got a job, a new car. In 1992, I moved my whole family to Abuja. While there, we were disappointed financially. All my expectations for a means of livelihood failed, and I could no longer cater for my family. So in October last year, we came back to Lagos. We sold all our belongings, including my car, bed, and mattress. I had to sell them in order to pay my transfer fare back to Lagos. Back in Lagos, God directed me to this church. On getting home, I told my wife that I had found a church that God had directed me to. We attended the December Breakthrough Seminar. At that seminar, the bishop said we should sow a seed. I had only 20 naira on me then, which I sowed. I didn't have any other money on me. But to the glory of God, on the first Monday of this year, I got a job. It was a project which fetched me more than 200,000 naira in 15 days. I was then able to buy a new car, a Bluebird 1.8. Here is the key. Also, the money I had been expecting since 1992 in Abuja was paid after the February Breakthrough Seminar, and those owing me pleaded with me to come back later to collect the balance. Sacrifice increased turnover. When the bishop said we should give a sacrificial offering, I had some money I had kept for some urgent needs, about 6,000 naira, which I had vowed not to use for anything other than for that need. So when the bishop said we should make the sacrifice, I did not. But when I got home and was praying, the Spirit of God said I should go and give that money. I obeyed, and the following day I came to drop it. 3 weeks later, I was called to quote for a business worth about 3,000 naira. I got the job and have executed it. Also, I have been in business for the past 3 years, and when I sat down recently to look at what God has done for me, I discovered that in 3 years, my turnover was close to 300,000 naira. But between January 26 and last March, I have recorded a turnover of close to 500,000 naira. I sold my salary as seed. My aunt, who resides in Holland, brought in some blazers for sale. She gave them to people to market for her at a ridiculously low price, but they later brought them back to me saying they couldn't sell them. One morning, a friend who was with me said we should administer the anointing oil on the blazers. We did so, and shortly after, the price appreciated. The same people who said they could not buy started coming to me for the blazers. Now I have sold over 8 dozen to the glory of God. Also, at the October Breakthrough Seminar, the Lord ministered to me to sow my October salary as seed. My salary was very little, and I had been thinking of what to do with it. The Holy Spirit gave me the courage to sow the seed. On getting to church again, the bishop said we are going to sow our cloud-filling seed. I made up my mind that I would do so. The moment I resolved this, the Holy Spirit pointed to something again. He said I could do better on my tithe, that there is still some space to be filled in the cloud. I increased my tithe to 20%. The Holy Spirit again pointed to something. He said, you can increase your offering. I did by 400%. Immediately, I made up my mind to resign from where I was working because the salary could not satisfy me anymore. I did so telling the people that I was going to work with Chevron. In December, God gave me some amount that could pay my salary for 8 months in my previous employment. All this amount without doing any job. Things started changing. On January 1, 1994, I discovered that I did not have 1 naira both in the bank and at home. I knew this because my wife was to cook the last meal on that day and needed salt, but there was none in the kitchen and we had no money to buy. So we ate without salt and left for church that day. Before I resigned from my last employment, I made adequate preparation for private business in three places. But one way or the other, they did not come through as I had planned. On February 24, my former employer paid my pension, which was just 12,000 naira. They could not pay the gratuity. Already, I had a commitment of 60% to the Lord. So I took out 8,000 naira from the money I was paid and brought it to church. I paid 3,000 naira to some of the people I was owing and gave my wife 1,000 naira. I had nothing left for myself. In March, I discovered that things started changing. I was able to employ people to work for me, and gradually things began to change. Now to the glory of God, when I calculated yesterday, I found out that the seeds that came out of me to the kingdom, both in cash and in kind, was well over 130,000 naira. My sweat for his sweat. At the October Breakthrough Seminar, the bishop taught on the secrets of God on supernatural supplies. He said, if one is not a kingdom communicator, he cannot receive supernatural supplies from God. Immediately he said that, a voice said to me, Helen, turn in your sweat for my sweat. After thinking about it, I said, God, I cannot pretend not to understand what you are telling me, but I have a problem. I have a husband who, if I ever say this kind of thing to, might fling my things out of the house. How do I handle that end? Before the end of the service, the same voice told me, just as I have said, say so to him. This was a Friday. On Saturday after breakfast, I had my bath and dressed up. I anointed my tongue and went to my husband. I said, listen to what God told me. He asked, what did he tell you? I said, God said I should turn my sweat over to him for his sweat. My husband said, go on and do it. Then I said, please get up and dress up because you will take me out. I did not tell him I was going to the bank. My bank operates on Saturdays. My husband drove me to my office. After he left, I took a bus and went to the bank. I withdrew all that was there and handed it over to God. Immediately after that, I was in my bathroom when the same voice said to me again, Helen, I am the person now manipulating the affairs of your life. Before now, I was always having problems in my office with my boss and all around. The same voice told me that he has made me an impossible nut to crack. I just believed God. About that time also, the bishop said the month of December was going to be our crowning month, that the blessing that would come to us will be more than what we had from January to November. God has dazed me. This is my tithe for this month, 27,800 naira. God has really dazed me because everybody around me just believed that I am the only person who can do things for them. This December, they dazed me with gifts that I never thought people would give to me. I give God praise for his faithfulness. I now eat very good food. On the first day of this year, the bishop said he sows everything he has and starts from 0 point financially in a new year. That day, I had only 1 naira with me, which I sold. I sell aluminium products and remember that I had some goods worth about 2,000 naira in my office. So when the bishop again called for a sacrificial offering, I sold those goods as well. Since that day, I tell you, I now eat very good food. Even when I want to caution my brother on the quantity of the food he cooks, the Holy Spirit reminds me that last December, I did not have enough food to eat, so I should not complain of food being too much now. In the month of March, God blessed me with a sum of 66,000 naira cheaply. I gave my chin chin quarter. When the bishop at the January Breakthrough Seminar said we should give a sacrificial offering, I wondered what I was to give. I don't have any bank account or anything worthy, but the Holy Spirit laid it on my had to give my chin-chin cutter. I'm a Kithra. I have been trusting God for a breakthrough in my business. But I give God all the glory for what He did for me this month. This month, an organization called me and ordered for breakfast worth about 12,000 naira. Since I started my catering business, I have never laid my hands on any business worth 5,000 naira. I gave a computer and printer. When the bishop said we should sow a seed, I gave a computer and printer. I had bought the computer for the company where I work, but they did not like it. So I had a 25,000 naira debt on my head. I believe God can pay the debt and recover some other things for me. The day after I sold the computer, I went to an office and met a brother that I had not seen in over 8 months. He told me to go and bring a quotation for some computers. I asked God, "You have provided this job. Where will I run to for help?" I was able to get a computer from a place that allowed me to go and supply and come back to pay for it. I made 25,000 naira on that computer. The brother said I should bring another quotation for yet another computer. I supplied it also. That same day, that same brother showed me a list of people who had applied to service their computers. He said I should quickly apply. I anointed my application letter, which the brother placed before all others. For servicing the computers, I will be earning 30,000 naira for just 12 appearances in a month. The brother said I should also go and write some accounting packages for them, all amounting to 100,000 naira. I give God all the glory. Provocative offering brings millions. I was challenged by my pastor to give a provocative offering, so I gave what I felt was provocative enough. I decided to give 500 naira, which I had never dropped before, as an offering. Later, I reasoned that if I wanted the offering to change my life, I should double it. So I decided to give 1,000 naira. Then we were told we could bring the money later if we didn't have it on our person. I then decided to make it 3,000 naira. I tore the paper again and decided on an offering that will raise me up for life. I made it 5,000 naira. To me, that was much at that particular time. As at then, I had just 14,000 naira for my business, part of which was not even mine. Despite this, I still dropped the pledge of 5,000 naira. But after that, things were still hard. I called unto God to intervene. As at that time too, for about 2 years, my husband had been out of job. I told God that if this was the case, then my pastor has not been telling us the truth. Then the Lord told me, as I was praying and crying to Him, by the time you drop half of this offering, I shall make a change in your life to make you know that the messages you have been hearing are true and the Bible you have been reading is true. Before then, I had given 2,000 naira out of 5,000 naira I pledged. After hearing this from the Lord, I rushed to pay another 1,000 naira, making it 3,000 naira altogether. Before then, people were owing me a lot, and I had decided not to go after them anymore. I just sat at home. But suddenly in December, people started coming to pay me. I never knew the returns of 5,000 naira was going to be in millions. All of a sudden, things began to happen miraculously. God blessed my husband so much that millions started rolling in. It's so hard for me to believe, but but I have to believe it. How it was happening, I don't really know. I give God all the glory. The greatest of all is that now, when I open the Bible to read, God gives me superb explanation of every passage. Friend, there is no shortcut. Any eaglet that must become a full-grown eagle and a high flyer must submit to the demands of rigorous exercise. It is exercise for a change of status. That is the way it happens. If you must enter into the covenant of financial rest, labor in the word. Labor in your belief of the demands of giving. It is time to keep pressing and pressing until you press your enemies out through the gate. I have discovered this and I have held on tightly to it all my life and have vowed to stay with it. Here I am today. I don't know the meaning of savings, yet I have never suffered financial lack. I am not a waster. I am simply an excited, intelligent investor. I use all the potentials of God inside me to locate investment avenues and exercise myself into them. This is my secret. There are times you have to fearfully sow. Fearful sowing results into fearful harvest. Enter the ark. Noah was preaching, warning the people that the flood was on its way coming, but everybody was laughing at him. It took him 120 years to prepare the ark. Only those who hearkened to his warnings and entered that ark survived the flood. God has been building an ark in the past years now, an ark of rescue that appeared stupid to some people. It is no longer stupid. An imminent economic collapse was a prophecy before. Now it is a reality. People are exchanging property for food. They are selling their television sets to eat and their cars to pay their house rent. Landlords have become tenants. Friends, this seemingly foolish ark is your only way of rescue. The covenant is the New Testament ark for rescue in the time of famine. You either enter inside it, stay there, and be preserved, or despise it and be destroyed. God will not allow any flood until an ark is set. For 120 years, Noah was building an ark, and nobody thought it would ever be of any use. But the day came when the ark became the only way of rescue. Friends, God is preparing an ark for your financial safety right now. If you mock it, you will be carried away by the plague of lack and want. God has promised he will never fail. We can trust him. We can take him at his word. He is always ahead for the safety of his people. The world is coming under the greatest plague of want. It is so clear in God's prophetic agenda. Isaiah 60 verse 2 to 3. When God speaks, whether it has ever been or not, you better shiver, for it is coming to be. God will not bend his word because of you. There is surely a flood of economic collapse coming upon humanity. Only those who stay in this ark shall be rescued. Friend, by the time the flood comes, you will know how to be a man of God and not a man of yourself. God will not feed on your tithe. He created you. Out of his fullness, he gave you just a tip of the iceberg. He can't be envious of you. Your position is irrelevant to God. The whole earth is like a drop of water in a bucket to him. You are not even an electron. You are just like the ant in your house. Salvation is the only thing that gives you value. If you despise it, your value is lost. God knows only Christians. He said, "I know my sheep and I call them by name." You do do not have a name outside salvation. God does not know the people in power in your country if they are not born again. Their names are not on his list. They are too short for God to see. All the things that look important to you here are nothing. This ark of safety is filling up already, and the flood level is rising. It is time to flee to the covenant mountain where there is rest. I am sent to tell you an ark is being prepared, and wise men are entering into it. Do not be the last to enter. The gates may be shut at any time. God sent Joseph to tell the children of Israel they do not have to die in Canaan, that there is room for them in Goshen. So Jacob and his sons crossed over from Canaan of dryness to the Goshen of milk and honey. May you cross over before the gate is shut. Suddenly, the ark they had mocked began to float. For 120 years, they had mocked Noah. Friends, before the gate is shut, you better run into it. It is the covenant ark of rescue versus the flood of financial calamity that is visiting the earth. That force of hell that says you will not rise shall be destroyed in your presence. Everyone that has mocked you before, except they repent, become children of God, and enter the covenant, will soon begin to hide their faces from you. I sat down one day and said to myself, where are my mockers? They are nowhere to be found. They are all in hiding. They were very many. Where were Noah's mockers when the flood began to rise? I entered the ark of the covenant when everybody thought there was no wisdom in it. I entered the ark of sacrificial giving, kingdom addiction, selfless service, living a lie that is solely unto God. Friend, it has paid off. Following God does not reduce anybody. I would like you to be sold out to God. You have started in this race. Do not let anybody outrun you. Do not let them. This seemingly stupid ark is the only way of rescue. You cannot despise it and survive the flood. To despise the ark means to go with the flood. The ark is where the key is. Jesus gave and gave until he gave his life. When the flood of death came, he rose above it. It could not swallow him. The covenant is your only way out of this flood of financial, social, and business death. You will rise above it as you enter and remain in the ark of the covenant. There is unemployment in every nation of the world today. The church of Jesus I grew up to know was a very poor one, but I kept telling the people that a time was coming when it would be a shame not to be a Christian in Nigeria. It is happening already. The covenant keeping God has drawn a timetable for his covenant children, and as long as you are a covenant keeper, you cannot be out of it. His glory will be seen upon you, and your enemies will go into hiding. As you stay on in this ark, the flood will no longer be a threat to your life. Can you picture Noah, his wife, and children peeping through the window and seeing floating bodies? They must have said to themselves, Lord, you are wonderful. We were stupid enough to follow our father.
Oh, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Jehovah, the man of war, his mercies endureth forever and ever. Oh, praise his holy name.
Whenever I sing this song, I end up in tears, because the integrity of the covenant has its emphasis on Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Every time you stay on in the covenant, you end up with a song in your mouth. Friend, you must stay on in the ark so that your safety can be established. Enter the ark. It takes that entrance to escape. I am sent to you for your escape. Having escaped escaped myself. I am sent to you for your healing, having been healed myself. I am sent to you for your protection against the arrows of the wicked, having escaped them myself. You must escape. All you need is to step into this ark and abide therein. The door will not be shut against you in Jesus' name.